Allow me to reintroduce myself. My name is I used to sell snowflakes by the OZ. Even back then, you could call me CEO of the ROC. At the fire plant, into the fire. I'd be the music world's number one survivor. Flyer than the piece of paper bearing my name. I got the hottest chick in the game wearing my name. That's right. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. For those of you that do not know me, what are you doing here? No, I'm just kidding. My name is Noah Greenspan, and tonight we're going to talk about exercise. And I said the best exercise, but we're going to talk about all the exercises. So I hope you have a good 4 or 5 hours. And then I'm going to open up for questions. So that should be at around midnight. So there's a lot of talk about what is the best exercise for people with respiratory disease. And there's a lot of talk about what is the best exercise for people without respiratory disease. And there are some principles that float around and some kind of taglines and, you know, like sound bites that go around, and everybody thinks they know the best. And some people, you know, actually do know the best, but there's no one best answer for everybody. So let's just start off with that. And some people, I don't like to say it because it's been used before, but I'll say it anyway. The best exercise is any exercise that you will do. So in other words, any exercise is better than no exercise. And another saying that I like is that it doesn't matter how slow you're going, you're still lapping everybody sitting on the couch. One thing I want to talk about is that very often when people are diagnosed with a chronic respiratory illness, you know, their whole lives kind of become about that illness, right? They become the illness, and their lives become these kind of black and white monochromatic versions of their former selves that are completely devoid of any type of art, music, fashion, culture, style, sports, fun. And their lives become about get up, take your medicine, eat your breakfast, go to the doctor, pick up your prescription, take your prescription, have dinner, watch TV. Notice I skipped lunch because you were too busy taking your medicines and nebulizing and all this other stuff. But it's really important that people understand that, you know, our goal is not that you live to rehab or not live to take care of your disease, but that you rehab so you can live and you take care of your disease so that you can so that you can live your life, because otherwise, what's the point, right? There's no sense otherwise. When we talk about shortness of breath, we talk about the fact that shortness of breath is multifactorial, right? And when you get diagnosed with an illness like COPD or asthma or chronic bronchitis or emphysema or pulmonary fibrosis or NTM or a bronchiectasis or cystic fibrosis, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, everything that happens to you becomes attributed to that disease. So people say, well, you know, I'm short of breath. Is that my COPD? Or I'm getting chest pain. Is that my pulmonary fibrosis? Or I have this fungus on my big toe. Is that my bronchiectasis? And it might be, but it's probably not. And one thing that I hate is that when everybody gets grouped into one little group and it's like this knee-jerk reaction, and social media has taken that kind of phenomenon and multiplied it by a billion, because now you don't even have to be a medical professional to answer the questions. Everyone and their mother is online answering these questions as if they know the answer. And we don't often know the answer. Recently, somebody was arguing with me online about the fact that they were telling me that masks don't protect the person wearing them, that the mask only protects the other person and the other person's mask protects you. And when I told her that that's not accurate, and she said, how do you know? And I said, well, because I've been doing what I do for 30 years and I have 20 years EMS experience, including during the first SARS epidemic when I was working in Queens. And I've, thank God, never gotten sick because I take precautions. And she said, well, I want to see some, you know, where are the studies? I want to see some studies. I said, well, why don't you do a Google search? Like, she wanted me to do the search. And she said, where are the 10 peer-reviewed studies? And I said, well, what do you do for a living? And she said, well, I work in a bakery. And I said, where do you think I'm going to find 10 bakers to write a study and review a study about, you know, whether the mask protects you or me? The joke being that, you know, everybody's talking, very few people are listening. And, you know, people say, well, I'm going to weigh all the evidence and I'm going to make my own decision, except that the average person, unless you have some training and experience, you're not really in a position to weigh the evidence, especially since people talk about evidence in a way that maybe it is, maybe it's not. Never has that been more evident to me than during COVID. Anyway, shortness of breath. Shortness of breath is multifactorial. And what I mean by that is that there are many, many factors that can contribute to how well or how poorly you breathe. Can it be your COPD? Yes. Can it be your pulmonary fibrosis? Yes. Can it be your asthma? Yes. But can it also be that you've been inside watching, you know, Squid Game for, you know, the last several weeks and you haven't done any exercise? It can be that. Can it be anxiety? Yes, it can be that. Can it be that you've gained 25 pounds? Yes, it can be that. It could be a million different things. And one thing that is really important is there's this saying by Steve Covey, who wrote The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. And it's, and they used it in the Clinton campaign. James Carville said it, when James Carville said it's the economy, stupid. And Steve Covey says it like this. He says, keep the main thing the main thing. So when I see people and I see people complain of shortness of breath, I always want to figure out what is the number one cause of their shortness of breath, because you can have COPD and that COPD may not be the main cause of your shortness of breath. It could be something else. And the reason that I know that is because if you look at the classic literature on pulmonary rehabilitation, they'll say people feel better. They'll say that people can do more. They'll say that people are less short of breath, but there's no change in pulmonary function, right? So if you feel better and you can do more and you, you know, you're less short of breath, but your pulmonary function is exactly the same, that tells us that there has to be other things besides the respiratory system and the lungs that affect how well or how poorly we breathe. And likewise, I've been saying for decades that we actually can improve pulmonary function if we do the right things. And a big part of that is if we do the right exercises the right way. So there's that. The other thing is, a lot of times people come and they say, well, you know, I feel much more short of breath than I did last year at this time. And when we do their PFTs also are unchanged. So if you can feel better or worse and your pulmonary function numbers are the same, then we have to ask ourselves, well, what is the main thing here? And then we have to sort of untwist this, kind of like when your kid comes to you with his fishing rod and it's all the whole spool of yarn is all tied up in one thing. We have to undo and try to peel away the layers of the onion to figure out what is what. Here's some basics. So in New York City, the three things that I hear most often are climbing the subway stairs, walking uphill, running for the bus, which I refer to as the New York City pulmonary triathlon. So it's like you run up one flight of subway stairs, run up a hill. If you catch the bus, you get a medal. And the thing that people have to realize is that your body gets good at doing what you ask it to do. So if you ask it to sit on the couch, flip the remote, watch Squid Game, and eat popcorn, that's what it gets good at doing. And it's going to reward you by putting on fat. It's going to reward you by reducing muscle. It's going to reward you by making your body less efficient, not just at using oxygen, but in all areas. And when we think about how does our body utilize oxygen, there are three main things that play a greater role than anything else. And it's really how good are your lungs at moving air into the body and into the bloodstream? How good is your heart at pumping blood? And how good are your muscles at using oxygen? All three get better with activity. All three get better with inactivity. Any questions so far? Does this sound familiar to people? All right. So what happens is people start to get short of breath at high levels of activity. And in the New York City pulmonary triathlon, the high levels of activity, the highest level of activity that most of us do, not me, because I'm spoiled and very dainty. I don't like to take the subway because usually I wind up getting into a fight on the subway when I do, because I have a bad attitude. But the thing is that think about walking up subway stairs. Why is that so difficult? Because in New York City, they're not built for comfort. They're built for space saving, right? So they're going to be steep. There's going to be a lot of them, and it's going to feel like walking straight up. And you literally have to lift your body up and carry it up those stairs. So very often, stairs are the thing that people eliminate first. And I know people who live in multi-floor homes, and they plan their day out so that everything they need from upstairs, they take down at the beginning of the day. And then everything that they're going to need for nighttime, they take up with them at the end of the day so that they only have to go down the stairs once a day and up the stairs once a day. Now, if you think about it and you're a stockbroker, let's say, who lives in Brooklyn, who's used to taking the subway, and you walk down two flights to get to the subway, up two flights to get out of the subway. There's four flights that, and at the end of the day, you walk two flights that go down to the subway, walk two flights up to get out of the subway. That's eight flights of stairs in one day, depending on if you're going to count it one way or the other, but we can call it four flights. So let's say you work 5 days a week. That's 20 flights of stairs per week. And now let's say you can't walk the stairs because you get too short of breath, or you're afraid that you're going to get a short of breath, right? Because we know that at a certain point, we become conditioned like Pavlov's dog to where, you know, it's like we start to get this sensation that we're about to get short of breath. And that that alone is enough to kind of trigger that cascade, that fight or flight response, where the harder we breathe or the harder it becomes to breathe, the more adrenaline we put out, the more anxious we become, and the harder it becomes to breathe because we breathe faster. And as we breathe faster, it starts to interfere with the movement of air, right? So it's a whole bunch of things that are not just physical in nature. They can be physical, they could be physiological, they can be psychological, they could be functional. But the idea is that if you are used to walking 40 flights of stairs a week times 50 weeks a year, if you get 2 weeks vacation, that's 2,000 flights of stairs that if you switch to the express bus instead of the subway, now you're walking 2,000 flights of stairs less this year than you did last year. So think about that. Don't you think that even if you didn't have lung disease, if you walk 2,000 flights of stairs less this year than you walked last year, that naturally your body's going to be deconditioned, your muscles are going to get weaker, all the systems that you use to walk up those stairs are going to become less efficient, and you will become more short of breath. Does that make sense? Does it sound familiar to anybody? Does anybody have any questions so far? So just to let you know, I know I'm screaming at you incessantly, which is my favorite pastime. But I'm going to make, you know, I really want this to be like a conversation. So if there are things you want to say, feel free to interrupt me. Whoever just did that, don't interrupt me when I'm talking. But the idea is, if you have something you want to say, by all means, please go ahead and say it. You're not going to throw me off. And if you do, it'll be more entertaining for you. But I will open up at a certain point when I take my first breath of the talk, and I will then allow for discussion. Here we go. So one of the good things is that, again, as I said before, the body gets good at doing what you ask it to do. And that's a bad thing if you're doing a lot of bad things and you're not doing any of the good things. But the good news, and I'm looking around the screens and I'm looking at all of you and I see all of you, and there's a joke, and I tell the same jokes every week. I don't know why. I just think they're such good jokes that I have to keep myself entertained. But there's a time, and I count on that one new person who hasn't heard the joke before, but there was a time when George W. Bush was speaking to this very fancy dinner very fancy dinner fundraiser. And he said, "Some people call you the elite, and I call you my base," right? And I say, "Some people call you the short of breath or the SOBs. I call you my base." And I say that because I look around this room and I'm looking at all 288 of you, and you look like the people I spend all day with every day, right? You guys look just exactly like my patients. So if you're sitting there thinking to yourself, "Hey, you know what? He's not talking to me. I'm too sick for this. I'm too short of breath for this. I'm too far gone for this," you're wrong. Okay, because I'm looking around and I see all of you. And like I said, you look like all the people that I spend all day with every day for the past 30 years. And like I say, some people call you a bunch of SOBs. I call you my base. Okay. And that means that everybody here can get better. Okay. It's just a matter of figuring out what the main thing is. And then once we deal with that main thing, then it's a matter of figuring out, okay, what's next? Okay. So let's start with that. We talked about shortness of breath. So when it comes to exercise, okay, everybody says, what's the best exercise? So I'm going to open the floor. You don't have to raise your hand or ask permission. If you want to talk, just unmute yourself. The only rules are, if you try to stage any kind of coup or in any way try to take over the meeting, the first time we will mute you, and the second time we will boot you. So as long as you don't try to take over the meeting, I will allow some heckling during the presentation. So what do you think is the best exercise? What do you guys think are the best exercises?
Walking.
Walking. Great exercise. I could make that case easily. What else?
Walking in the pool.
Walking in the pool. Well, if you have a pool, then yes, that's great. Not
going up and down those stairs. But
going up and down the stairs. Okay, what else? Give me two more.
Yoga.
Dancing.
Dancing.
Any sort of movement.
Muscle exercises.
All right.
Upper body.
What? Pilates?
Upper body.
Upper body. Okay. So look, so we can make a case for every one of those things, why they're the best exercise. And we can make a case for every one of those things, why they're not the best exercise. Okay. So let's just, I want you to leave here tonight with things you can use right away. I want you to leave here with principles, not personal principles, because I don't think I'm in the position to teach you about that. No, I'm just kidding. But the idea is that I want you to leave with an understanding so that you can apply what I'm talking about to your life, however it is, so that, like, if you're not fancy like Diane and you have a pool in your backyard, then you can find another exercise, you know, that you can do yourself. But when I think about exercise, okay, for respiratory patients, I break them down into a number of different categories. And incidentally, if you don't know, the Pulmonary Wellness Foundation has a free online pulmonary rehab program. Okay. And I know that the COPD Foundation has recently made one. And I know that the Pulmonary Fibrosis Foundation has just made one recently. And I know some other people have made some recently. But just remember, like Hiram Bingham walking to the top of Machu Picchu, clearing the brush for the first time, there can only be one first. And you know who it was, my friends. You know who it was. So
Exactamundo.
Anyway, I'm just kidding. I kid the COPD Foundation and I kid the Pulmonary Fibrosis Foundation. But the thing is that you can do these things and we know that they work. I don't care if you use mine. I don't care if you use the COPD Foundation. I don't care if you use the Pulmonary Fibrosis Foundation. Because I know that these are vetted, right? So you said, what is the best exercise and what is not the best exercise? So walking up and down stairs, Susanna, you said walking up and down stairs. So that's a great exercise, right? It's certainly a very vigorous exercise because we said that this is, you know, something where you literally have to pick yourself up and carry yourself up the stairs. But one reason why it might not be a great exercise is because what if you can't do it, right? What if you're too winded to walk up the stairs? Yeah. Or again, when I talk about shortness of breath, I'm not just going to, you know, you don't have to just think shortness of breath or say, oh, shortness of breath, this isn't for me. You could think hip pain, back pain, chest pain, you know, knee pain, whatever it is. And that's when I say keep the main thing, the main thing, because the thing about it is that very often, even you can have COPD and that may not be your main limiting factor. You could have pulmonary fibrosis. And guess what? You could have a severely arthritic knee with no cartilage. And it could be that knee that's getting you and not your COPD before your COPD kicks in, right? So the idea is, what is the main thing that we are trying to deal with? Now, boot camp focuses on the following. And I'm just going to mute everybody for a second. And I'm going to see if I'm still muted. I'm not. Good. Okay. So number one, we start with breathing exercises, okay? But before we start with breathing exercises, we have to start with a really good evaluation. And when we talk about shortness of breath, in addition to it being multifactorial as to what could cause it, multiple systems between your neck and your belt, okay, can have symptoms that are very similar to each other, right? So what I mean by that is that shortness of breath is a non-specific symptom. And a non-specific symptom doesn't mean like we don't know what it is. Of course, we know what shortness of breath is. Of course, we know what chest pain is. Of course, we know what pressure in our abdomen or our sternum is. But that can come from your respiratory system. It can come from your cardiovascular system. It could come from your GI system, right? And my philosophy and my way of treating patients, whether it's in rehab or EMS, is I always assume the worst, not because I'm a pessimist, okay? But I always assume the worst and then I work backwards. So in other words, if you're telling me you have pressure in your chest, although that can be your airways, if you have asthma or COPD, or if you have, you know, bloating in your abdomen, although that can be something else, I always assume that it's cardiac in nature rather than that bean burrito that I had for lunch today. Okay. And the reason for that is because if I assume it's the bean burrito, which I didn't really have a bean burrito for lunch today, I wish I did. But the point is that if I assume it's my stomach or if I assume it's that bean burrito and it turns out to be my heart, well, then we have a problem. Right? Because you know what one of the number one symptoms of people having a heart attack is? It's a river in Africa called the Nile. Okay. And a lot of people are having heart attacks. They're having chest pain. Probably deep down, they know they're having a heart attack, right? But they're like, nah, I think it's that bean burrito. You know what? I think that shrimp salad I ate was old. I think I waited too long to eat that shrimp salad. Right. And they don't want to call EMS. They don't want the ambulance coming to their home. They don't want to make a big fuss. And the thing is that when it comes to the heart, time is muscle. And it's really important that you act quickly. So I assume it's the worst. And if I think I'm having a heart attack and I go to the hospital and my heart checks out fine and they say, well, what did you have for lunch? And I say, well, I had a bean burrito, some prunes, some club soda, and some, you know, then that's a funny thing, right? But if I assume it's the bean burrito and they say, guess what? You had a heart attack. That's not funny anymore. So first and foremost, before you get going on any type of exercise, safety first. And that means make sure you get checked out by your doctor. Get a cardiac workup and an EKG is not enough, right? An EKG is not enough, depending on who you are. Get obviously a pulmonary workup. And if you're having something that could be reflux or gastrointestinal related, it's worth seeing a gastroenterologist. But first and foremost, I worry about the things that are going to be dangerous to you more than I worry about the things that are going to be uncomfortable for you. I worry about the things that are going to be life-threatening more so than I worry about the things that are going to affect any one of your limbs. And that's a good kind of rule of thumb. So get checked out. What do I like patients to have done? Certainly an EKG, right? But an EKG at rest is almost useless unless you're actually having a problem at that moment. It's like a photograph, right? So it's like if I say to you, hey, everybody, we're going to take a group photo right now and everybody's smiling and we get this beautiful photo and I turn around and everybody gives me the finger, that's like an EKG, right? So it's like an EKG can be perfect in the doctor's office. You could walk out and something's wrong. So if there's any type of rhythm disturbance or any type of electrical disturbance, then certainly it's worth getting a Holter monitor, which is an EKG that you can wear for 24 hours or more. And that will give you the greatest chance of catching something if you do have an arrhythmia. And that's why we use EKGs every session with every patient when we do rehab. And when we first opened, everybody said, these are pulmonary patients. You don't need EKGs. They're not cardiac patients. But most, and I say this because I live in New York City with a lot of sharks, most of the pulmonary patients I've seen also have hearts. Some are questionable, okay? But the idea is that I want to make sure that your heart is also okay, because we don't want to get your lungs in shape only to find out that you have a heart problem, because that happens sometimes, right? Think about it. If you get short of breath when you walk up half a flight of stairs, well, guess what? We may never get to the point where your heart problem says, hey, remember me? Because you're stopped by shortness of breath before we ever reach that threshold where your heart says we might have a problem. And the other thing is that very often when pulmonary patients get an exercise test or a stress test, the test that they use, in my opinion, is the wrong test. Okay. So a lot of times when somebody wants to check you out, they'll do a 6-minute walk test. I could go for 6 hours talking about why I don't like the 6-minute walk test. I see other rehabilitation professionals on here who are like, oh, here we go again. Here he goes. He's going to talk about the 6-minute walk test. Okay. I'm going to tell you why I don't like it. And then again, you can listen to this, what I say, and then you can make your own decisions. And I'll tell you why I don't like the exercise treadmill test that most people use. Let's see if I could still talk after I drink this scotch. So the other thing is this, think about a 6-minute walk test. I'll tell you why I don't love it. Jane Martin, if you're here, and I think you are, cause I saw you, listen to this. Jane Martin is a famous respiratory therapist. She has a new book out. Jane, what's the name of your book? I think it's called 365 Days with COPD, and I read it in one night. It's a great book. But listen to this, Jane, because this wasn't in your book. So when we talk about a 6-minute walk test, right, what I don't like about it, and it's not because I'm a control freak, which I am, but this isn't why I don't like the 6-minute walk test, it's because it's too patient controlled. Right. And what that means is that, number one, often the instructions that are given are not given in a uniform way. And for a test to be uniform and reproducible, we have to tell you the exact same thing so that everybody goes into the test. You know, it's like, anyone see that Hanna-Barbera cartoon like 50 years ago, Catch That Pigeon? Where like they, Penelope Pitstop, Catch That Pigeon, where they all have like a different car. And the thing is that, you know, if we give different instructions, the patient can misunderstand and they can not do the test properly. Or patients sometimes strategize. I've heard people say, well, am I supposed to do good or bad? If you do too good, they'll take away your rehab, right? Or they say, oh, if you do too bad, you won't get your rehab. Or if you do this, you do that. So that's not how it's supposed to be. That's what one of the limitations. The other thing is, sometimes someone will get short of breath. Someone will stop them, tell them to stop, give them oxygen. Too many changes. It's got to be uniform. I've used it. I've done it 5,000 times probably. I don't like it. But what I like is a treadmill test. I'll tell you my favorite exercise of all, if I'm going to recommend one, is the treadmill. But I'll tell you, Jane, here's the important part. The treadmill test that most people use during diagnostic exercise testing, it's called the Bruce protocol. And the Bruce protocol starts at one point. Don't take notes because you don't need to know this stuff. Just listen and understand, okay? I'll tell you when there's something important and this is being recorded. But the Bruce protocol, think back to your stress test. And the Bruce protocol starts at 1.7 miles per hour with a 10% incline. So if you're short of breath and you're on oxygen and you haven't walked up a hill in 6 months and this test starts, it's very anxiety provoking. You get short of breath and you have to stop the test very often before we learn anything about you, right? So if the thing that stops your test is shortness of breath and or lower body fatigue, and that stops before we get any hemodynamic data. And what I mean by hemodynamic data is a high enough heart rate, a good enough heart rhythm, blood pressure, oxygen saturation at higher levels of activity, then that test is useless. So a lot of times I get reports from doctors that say patient exercised for 1 minute and 13 seconds negative for ischemia. And negative for ischemia means that they didn't find any parts where the heart wasn't getting enough blood, but they only did it for 1 minute and 13 seconds because the patient was short of breath and the patient's legs were too tired because the machine was too fast and going too far uphill. And I can take that test and crumple it up, throw it in the garbage because it's useless. And one of the things that's important is that one of the reasons we do exercise testing is because we want to establish a baseline for patients. And then depending on what you do for that baseline, we will usually create an exercise prescription for you that is some percentage of that, right? Except that for patients with respiratory disease, it's not usually, I'm not saying it can't be, but under more circumstances than not, it's not a hemodynamic, meaning it's not a cardiac endpoint that stops the test. It's shortness of breath and or lower extremity fatigue. And what that means is that if I take that intensity that you did, and I cut it by, you know, 30% to say you should exercise at 70% of that, well, that means like sit here and have a pina colada. So it's really important that the people who are doing rehab really understand the physiology and understand why we're doing what tests, why we're not doing other tests, and then what to do with that information. Everything I just said, which has been now 30 minutes, was a long way of me saying, make sure you check with your doctor before beginning any exercise program, okay? That's the sum total of the first half hour of this program. Different types of exercise and different, you know, different ways of thinking about exercise. I'm going to tell you something. I don't like to speak in standards. I don't like to speak in everyday terms. I like more colorful, you know, language. I'm going to try not to curse tonight. But the thing is that when we talk about exercise, there's a thing called FIT, F-I-T-T, right? And it's a great way of thinking of things. And what it stands for, Sue, you don't have to take notes. I just told you that. Sue, don't reach for a pen. Put it down and put the pen down and step away from the pad. So just listen for a minute because this makes sense. If you hear it, it's going to make sense to you. Frequency, intensity, time, and type. Right? Those are all the things that you can change when it comes to your exercise program. You could change how often you could work out. You could change how hard you can work out. You could change how long you work out, and you can change the type of exercise. Sue, listen, because you can memorize this. FIT, F-I-T-T, frequency, intensity, time, and type. How frequently should we work out? All right. Show of hands, since I don't want you all unmuting again, and Beth is going to have to shoot you out of the sky, even though you're innocent. How many times a week should we exercise? How many people say once a week? Raise your hand. All right. Once a week is like zero times a week. Just let me tell you that. So when you go to rehab and they say, we want you to come 2 or 3 times a week, and you're like, well, I can only come once a week. To me, I say once a week is like zero times a week. And quite frankly, that's not worth either of our time, right? Because you're not going to get any better. And then you're going to come and you're going to say, hey, you know what? You told me this. And the boot camp, if boot camp doesn't work for you, I'm going to give you your money back, okay? So if boot camp does, if you do 42 days of boot camp and it doesn't work, write to me and I'm going to give you all your money back, okay? But remember, I told you it was free. So the thing is, don't waste your time, but boot camp will work. We know it works. But here's the thing. the minimum, in my opinion, in my experience of what's going to get you better is going to be twice a week. And twice a week of vigorous exercise, and I hate to say this, people get mad at me because they're going to be like, he said I only have to exercise twice a week. No, it's not that you only have to exercise, because there's exercise and there's activity and there's movement and there's all this other stuff. But if you get in two vigorous workouts a week and on the other days you stay active, okay, then that's going to work for you if you do it right. And I mean, if you do the right workouts. So how many people think three days a week? How many people think 4 days a week? Five. Every day. Rob, you don't think every day? Yes, you do think every day. Rob, how much are you confident in this answer? Are you willing to say every day, or do you want to trade every day for what's behind curtain number two?
Activity
every day. Absolutely. Activity every day. So your body works a lot like clay, and it works a lot like plaster, and it works a lot like jello, right? So the thing is that if you take this thing of clay and it doesn't move, it's going to harden. But if you keep working it and moving it, it stays soft, it stays pliable. And that's how your body works also, to a large extent. Okay. But activity every day. Now, boot camp, I held off for a long time about doing an online program, a remote program. I had two reasons for it. Number one was I questioned the safety of it, right? Because I wasn't sure, because we monitored people so closely that I was worried, well, how could we ask people to exercise at home alone? And the other thing was that I questioned the effectiveness of it, because one of the beauties of having all this monitoring equipment and monitoring people so frequently is that we can push them, because even though they go, oh my God, my heart is beating out of my chest. And we say, how fast do you think your heart is going right now? And they say, I think my heart is going 180. And then we say, would you be surprised to know your heart is only going 85? Like, oh my God. It's like that part where Pete Davidson, he thinks he's drowning, but he's only in 2 feet of water. And he said, just stand up, you're okay. But the idea is, the way we got around that was, instead of giving you two or three vigorous workouts a week, we started at a very, very low level, 4 minutes of activity on day one, and added 1 minute per day. And by the end of it, you go from 4 minutes to 30 minutes. It works for almost everybody. And we have not had reports of anybody getting hurt from it. Now, you know, the thing about it is that you have to do something every day. But by doing it every day, even though it's lower intensity, we still got a lot of bang for our buck. So frequency, we'll say some activity every day. You can work out twice a week. You can do a formal workout three times a week. If you're one of those people that actually like exercise, or what I call the maniacs or the mentally ill, you could do it more often. But the thing is that you got to get in two good workouts a week, and you got to be active on the other day. Right. He's like, all right, leave me alone already. I'm watching something. But the thing is also, so when we talk about, I'm going to talk about, time of exercise, and I'm going to talk about type of exercise first, and then we're going to go into intensity. So when we talk about type of exercise, okay, there's a lot of ways to break it down. You could break it down into aerobic, or what we call cardio. You could break it down into strength training. You could break it down into flexibility training. You could break it down into breathing. You could break it down into balance training, right? So that's what I think they all are. I think it's first and foremost breathing retraining. So we have to teach you how to breathe most effectively. Okay. I think cardio is very important. I think flexibility is very important. I think balance is very important, especially as we get older. I think strength training is very important. But here's the good news. Okay. Because there's a lot of people, and Sue, I know you're one of them, right? Who's going to get out their pad and they're going to be like, all right, we're about to get to strength training. And then we're going to go to balance. And then we're going to go to flexibility. And then we're going to go to breathing. Here's the thing, any one of those, none of them exist alone, right? So when you're doing your yoga or you're stretching, guess what? You're also getting breathing benefit from that, in addition to flexibility training. You're also getting strength benefit from that. You're also getting balance benefit from that. So that's good. When you're walking on a treadmill, yes, that's a cardio exercise, but if you're stretching your legs more than you've been stretching them for the last 5 years, you're also getting flexibility benefit. You're also getting strength benefit as you use more muscle. You're also getting breathing benefit. So, you know, I'm very specific scientifically, but over time I've adapted to where, you know, I really have come to believe, especially during a pandemic where most of us have done nothing but watch Boardwalk Empire or Dexter for like 2 years. Well, I was on a call and one of my patients said, I think she said something like she watched like a crazy number, like 70 something episodes of Dexter. And I was like, wow. But the idea is that it's really more important that you choose something that you like and you do it on a regular basis. And consistency is everything. Okay. If you can walk a mile today, then there's no reason why you can't walk a mile tomorrow. If you can walk a mile tomorrow, there's no reason why you can't walk a mile on Friday. And if you can walk a mile on Friday, there's no reason why you can't walk a mile on Saturday. But what happens to people when they start getting a symptom, and again, it doesn't matter if it's shortness of breath or chest pain or hip pain or back pain or knee pain or foot pain or jock itch. I threw that in there for you, Rob. But the idea is that I'm not revealing anything that you told me in confidence. I'm just speaking generally. But the thing is that usually what happens is we get short of breath and we stop for 6 months, and then we try 6 months from now and we can't walk that mile. And we say to ourselves, hey, guess what? My lungs must have gotten a lot worse, right? And maybe they did and maybe they didn't, but it's not usually that. It's usually something else. It's usually the inactivity. And sometimes the lungs are exactly the same, where you've put on some weight or you've lost some weight, or this, that, and the other thing. But again, we have to do a little bit of detective work in order to find out what's really causing the problem. I don't mind telling you that 95% of what I know, I learned from watching House. No, I'm just kidding. 99% of what I know, I really learned from patients and from Rubik's cubing situations around in a million different ways and trying a million different things. And if one thing doesn't work, like there's a whole bunch of stuff that are going to work very well for a lot of people, but not for everybody, right? Those are like the C students. Like most people are C students. That's why they call it average. So for you C students, you're going to come in and most things are going to work for you, right? They're just going to work. They're not going to be great. They're not going to be terrible. They're going to work. Then we have the B students who are going to be a little challenging, right? Then we have like the D minus or A plus students. Deborah, I'm looking at you, who came in and on the first day told me what you're going to do and what you're not going to do, right? And eventually we became friends because I told you I don't allow members from rival gangs in the Pulmonary Wellness and Rehabilitation Center, okay? But the idea is that if something is not working for you, it doesn't mean nothing's going to work for you. It means that we have to be smart and try different things. And one of the beauties of boot camp, and this is not a shameless plug because it's free, right? I have no reason to plug it. It's free. I'm not making any money off it. I just want to give it to you. But the idea is that one of the things about boot camp is we tried to show you a smorgasbord. It's like the TGI Fridays sampler, right? Where we give you one chicken wing, one mozzarella stick, one stuffed mushroom, one shrimp, and you get to see what you like. And then you do that. Okay. We have day one of every week is breathing. Day three of every week is yoga. Day five of every week is Tai Chi and Qigong. Day seven of every week is meditation, because all these things play a role in how well or how poorly you feel. If you know the thing that I repeat incessantly, like Rain Man for the last 20 years, I talk about ultimate pulmonary wellness. And I say there's five things that I find to be the most helpful for you more than any other. Okay. And we all want that magic pill, right? We all want that device that Suzanne Summers shows us. We're like, if I can only squeeze my legs together enough times, I'm not going to be short of breath anymore. Right. And see that? And the thing is that, the thing is that there's not really that one thing, right? And so rather than you look for that type of oil or the tincture or the plant or this, that, the other thing, stick to the basics. And the basics, as I tell you every week, medical is having the right doctors, having the right team, taking the right medications, taking the medications properly. 20% of the picture. It's only 20% of the picture. In most cases in our society, especially in America, that's 90% of the picture, right? So we live in a very medication and procedure-based society where on the way out, your doctor may say, lose some weight, get some exercise, right? But that's so little. So like we ask people to do things. And if we spend 90% of the time talking about this medication or this procedure, and we don't talk about the lifestyle issues, which is where the big bang for your buck is, then you don't get that message, right? So medical, exercise 20%, nutrition 20%. Next time we're going to talk about nutrition. I'm going to have some nutrition geniuses on to talk about the science, and I'll be on as a gourmet to tell you the best restaurants. Also managing stress, anxiety, and depression, right? Because it's very anxiety provoking to not be able to breathe. And it's very stressful to not be able to do the things that we want to do. And it's very depressing. And the way that I hear some people describe it is it feels like my life has gotten smaller, right? But our lives get smaller and things go in waves, right? So if you think about the things that allowed your life to get smaller, we can break out of that and we can enlarge our lives again. It happens to all of us. It doesn't just happen to people with chronic illnesses. I feel the same way. I have my ups and downs. The last 2 years have been crazy, but I try to constantly be pulling myself out of it. And we all have bad days. We all have, you know, days that we feel great. And I talk about it like surfing. It's like, if you go out and the waves are there, we surf. And some days there's no waves. And on the days that the waves aren't there, we go home. Okay. I had a yoga teacher named Stephanie Pope who said it like this, and it's a great way of doing this. Sometimes, we feel good. And this is not her. I'm going to talk about Stephanie in 20 seconds, but I always talk about these different things, and whether it's medications, exercise, nutrition, stress, anxiety management, and prevention of infection, it's like putting money in the bank. So every time you do something good for yourself, you're putting money in the bank. And some days you can only put in a quarter or a dime or a nickel, right? But that's still better than withdrawing, right? It's like when you leave Atlantic City and you're like, well, I didn't lose money. That's kind of like winning money, right? And it's like, you know, a lot of this is like not losing ground. We don't want to lose ground. So at least if we hold our own, right? And then on the days where you're flush, and then on the days where you feel great. And if there's any post-COVID long haulers on this call, just understand that what I'm about to say doesn't apply in the same way to COVID that it does to cardiopulmonary disease, because on the days that you feel great, I'm not recommending that you push yourself, because we know that that can have ramifications to it also that are not always positive. Okay, so keep that in mind. But on the days that you feel flush, well, put more money in the bank. Put a little extra, do that extra block. You know what I mean? Take the walk instead of the taxi, and so on and so forth. And what I was going to tell you before is that my yoga instructor, Stephanie Pope, used to say this: as long as you are putting in 100% of the effort, you still get 100% of the benefit. And that's how I feel about rehab. Okay. I feel like if you come in, it may not be your best day, and it may be that you shouldn't exercise today. Like someone came to me today, they were exhausted. They told us that they just worked out with their trainer earlier that day. So that's not the person to exercise. But if you could come in and maybe we do half what we did last time, that's preventing us from losing ground, right? A lot of people say, well, you know, my lungs must have gotten worse. Well, guess what? Your lung function peaks at what age? Does anybody know? All right, show of hands. How many people think it peaks at age 10, 20, 30, 40? Deborah, you think it peaks at 30? Sue, you think it peaks at 40? It peaks at 20, right? So that means that even if you don't have a lung condition, you're going to lose a tiny bit of lung function every year unless you fight for that lung function. And even if you fight hard for that lung function, you still may lose it. And this is why sometimes people will say, I'll say, do you smoke? And they say, no, it can't be that. I quit smoking 30 years ago, right? Well, maybe you did, but maybe before that you smoked 2 packs a day since you're 15 and the damage was done, but now we've lost that natural and you've hit that kind of critical point where, where now you're starting to feel symptoms. Anyway, short story long, But the point being that there's different kinds of exercise, and don't think that just because you're doing one, that you're not getting the benefit from the other. So flexibility exercise, I'm doing this. I'm also opening my lungs and getting breathing benefit. I'm raising my arms. I'm also getting strength benefit. I'm also getting, you know, these other types of benefits. So don't make it so strict and, you know, so absolutely control that you find ways not to do it. Don't get the idea that if I don't do it exactly right, I'm not going to get any. See Fred Fox, he went right to it. He saw me do this. He was like this. Now he's scratching his chest. Soon he's going to be beating it like a gorilla. There he is. Fred, I knew I could hypnotize you. You didn't know I could do it from New York, but that's good. Now Fred's beating his chest and clucking like a chicken. Hang on. Let me unmute Fred to see if this is actually happening. All right, Fred, it took too long. The joke is over. Forget about it. All right, we'll do that later. Get ready, okay? Find your mute button. All right, so anyway, let's go back to this. What are important to you? Breathing it. Now he's got it. Fred?
I'm here. Right.
Are you clucking like it? Where are you, in North Carolina?
No, Oklahoma, Southwest Oklahoma.
Okay, it's good to see you.
Nice to see you.
I hope you got my email the other day.
I did.
Sorry it took me so long. All right, other things. So I'm going to go in order, breathing exercises, right? So what are the breathing exercises? So everybody talks about pursed lip breathing, diaphragmatic breathing, paced breathing, right? So pursed lip breathing is, diaphragmatic breathing is, paced breathing is in, blow, 2, 3, 4. Now, let me tell you something about this, okay? Those things are not necessarily going to make you less short of breath on their own. Right. I think of those things, they are exercises and you have to learn how to do them. And Thea, you're tired in Australia, aren't you? It's late, isn't it? I saw that yawn, and your son got hairier since the last time I saw him. Your dog got hairier too. Nice to see you guys. So the other thing is that, you know, don't think that by sitting here and doing pursed lip breathing all day, that all of a sudden you're going to be able to walk up the stairs. Right. But this pursed lip breathing, this diaphragmatic breathing, this paced breathing, this controlled breathing are all tools that will let you do the things that are actually going to make your body better. And another thing is that, you know, people talk about diaphragmatic breathing. Just keep in mind that all breathing is diaphragmatic, right? You can't take a breath without your diaphragm unless you're on a ventilator or unless, you know, your diaphragm is paralyzed. So it doesn't matter if you breathe in through your nose, doesn't matter if you breathe in through your mouth, doesn't matter if you blow out through your nose or your mouth. Well, you don't want to blow out through your nose, especially in public. But the idea is any way you slice it, your diaphragm has to contract. But what we want to do is we want to quiet the muscles of your neck. We want to quiet the muscles of your chest. We want to quiet the muscles of your shoulders and back so that your diaphragm is functioning the most effectively. Okay. But keep in mind that these exercises on their own are not going to make you substantially better during activity. But breathing exercises are very important. Cardio, okay? Cardio, aerobic exercise. Cardio and aerobic exercise is really important for cardiopulmonary patients because this will help your body use oxygen best, okay? And most efficiently. So cardio will help the mechanics of your lung. Cardio will help your heart become more efficient. It will help your muscles become more efficient at extracting oxygen from the blood. And all these things will make you more efficient, okay? And then little by little, we want to increase the intensity. Now, if you look back at classic pulmonary rehab, and unfortunately, it happens today in a lot of places too, the idea was slow and low intensity and long duration, right? And I get it. I understand why it happened like that. I understand why people do it, because when people are short of breath, it's scary to think about walking fast up a hill, carrying things, right? But if you think about it in terms of metabolic equivalence or MET levels, right? So if your life requires this metabolic, this level of metabolism, or this workload, this level of METs, if I exercise you down here, it doesn't matter if we do this till the cows come home, this doesn't make your life better. right? And why do people exercise people at a low level? It could be because of shortness of breath. It could be because of deconditioning. It could be because the staff is afraid to push people. It could be because, you know, you can't do that much more, but it could be because your oxygen goes lower, right? How many people, when you go to rehab, when your oxygen goes low, they stop you or they tell you to slow down, right? I have a different philosophy, okay? Because if this is what your life needs, okay, and I exercise you down here, well, that doesn't change your life that much, right? But if this is what your life needs, and I exercise you up here by hook or by crook, whatever that means, and that may mean that I have to give you 15 liters of oxygen, okay? That may mean that we need three people to stand next to you when you're on the treadmill or to help you get out of your seat. It may mean that we need to go in 1 minute intervals and take a break and take a break and take a break. And it may take us 2 hours to get 15 minutes of exercise in, right? But again, I consider myself what I call Malcolm X rehabilitation, which means by any means necessary. And whatever it takes for us to figure out your Rubik's Cube. And, you know, if you've ever seen the Da Vinci Code, you know that cryptex that they have that has this code. It's really about individualizing care for every patient and figuring out their own individual cryptex. And I used to think that was challenging for pulmonary patients. After 2 years of treating COVID patients, pulmonary patients are like, oh, this is a piece of cake. But I've had 2 years that where I felt stupider than I've ever felt. You know, I'm used to when people don't know what to do with somebody, they send them to me and we figure it out using a crystal ball. With COVID, it's much more challenging. But the idea is, don't think that because something works for somebody else, that it's definitely going to work for you. And conversely, just because something didn't work for somebody else doesn't mean that it's not going to work for you. So I have this thing that I learned from my, at the time, 6-year-old niece. And it says, don't yuck my yum, right? So if something's working for somebody else, don't tell them why it's not good, okay? And sometimes a lot of these things, I'm not saying it's psychological, right? Saying that something is psychological or anxiety has gotten a bad name, because sometimes when people don't understand the physiology, they attribute a person's problems to being only psychological. But there's definitely a psychological component to everything that we do. And I like to plant little subliminal seeds in people's heads that ultimately say, yes, we can. And yes, you can. You know, I don't know if you know the story about how John Lennon met Yoko Ono, but Yoko Ono was an artist and there was a ladder up to the ceiling, and John Lennon walked up to the ladder and there was a tiny piece of paper there. And does anybody know what that piece of paper said? All right, I'm going to give you some multiple choice. How many people think it said avocado? Nobody thinks it said avocado. How many people thinks it said positive? How many people think it said energy? How many people think it said yes? It said yes, okay. And John Lennon always said that what he loved about it, if it had said no, he would have had no interest in being involved with Yoko Ono. And, you know, John Lennon was a little crazy, okay, but, and so was Yoko Ono. But the idea is you will do the things, and it's not all in your head, and it's not, I'm not one of those people who's like, well, just turn that frown upside down, okay? That's not me, okay? I'm a cynical New Yorker and I get more jaded by the day, okay? COVID has made me like I'm practically a jade Buddha, okay? But the idea is, one of my other favorite quotes, John Wooden, okay, basketball coach, who says, don't let the things that you cannot do interfere with the things that you can do, okay? Don't let the things that you cannot do interfere with the things that you can do. So that might mean, well, you cannot walk up a flight of subway stairs, but you can walk around the block. So do the things you can do and build up to doing the things that you cannot do. And another thing, Peggy, why are you rolling that pencil around at me? You look like you're casting some kind of spell or something. Are you making a brew or a broth? Another thing is this, okay? There's another saying that I love. It says the best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago. And the second best time is today. So guess what? If we've been eating cheeseburgers and fries for the last 20 years, we can't change that. But we could change what we eat today and we could change what we eat tomorrow. If we haven't exercised in 20 years, we can't do anything about that. But we can change what we do going forward. And again, every little bit adds to your bank account, adds to your savings, your health, wealth. And the more health, wealth you have saved up when you actually have a crisis, when the boiler breaks and you have to have a new boiler put in, well, guess what? Now you've got a reserve. So maybe instead of winding up in the hospital on a vent, maybe you spend 2 weeks at home eating, you know, matzo ball soup and you get through it. So again, everything that you do contributes to what you can do. Let me go back to frequency, intensity, time, and type. So frequency every day, intensity. I don't believe in a target heart rate for people. There's different ways that we can measure intensity. So it could be a target heart rate. We could see what is your heart rate at a certain level of activity. It could be systolic blood pressure. It could be RPE, which is rating of perceived exertion. So people talk about, you know, we'll ask you, is it fairly light, somewhat hard, or hard, right? So we've all seen these things before where they show you this. We say, tell me about your breathlessness. Is it fairly mild, somewhat strong, or strong? And so if you're doing the same exercise and 2 months ago it was hard for you and now it's only somewhat hard, well, that means you're making progress. Or if you do the same exercise today that you did 2 months ago and 2 months ago your heart rate went up to 120 and today it only went up to 105, well, that's progress. And again, when I look around the room, okay, and I look at all of you, who's the oldest person in the room? Raise your hand. No, I'm just kidding. But listen to this. I mean, I'm not joking when I say I have photographs of our center where we've had as many as 7 people in the room over 95 at the same time. Okay. So to me, I don't believe age is a factor. It's not nothing, but a lot of times people say, well, you know what? You're 80 years old. You can't get better. That's absolutely not true. Okay. 80 is middle age to me. When you're 100, then you're old. Okay. Actually, really 101. My oldest patient was 107. But the idea is, don't get the idea. And the fact that you're even here is telling me that you believe you can get better, or you have at least hope that you can get better. And I'm telling you that you're right about that. Okay. What a lot of people consider to be the end of the line, that's what my team says. This is the starting line. And we say, you know what? This may be complex. Yes, you may have lung disease. Yes, you may have arthritis. Yes, you may have diabetes. Yes, you may have had a heart attack 15 years ago, but you know what? You're going to live your life, and let's figure out how to do that. And the thing is, if you're walking around and you're doing all these things anyway, then you might as well do it in a way that's based on science and that's based on the experience of other people. So types of exercise, we talked about breathing exercise, cardio, strength training. Strength training is like weight training. Okay, you could do it with bands, you could do it with kettlebells, you could do it with dumbbells, you could do it with machines, strength training. Flexibility, okay, we want to make sure that our bodies, our muscles, our joints, our tendons, our ligaments, okay, remain supple so that when we need to take a breath, we have the range of motion to do it. And if I'll just give you one very simple thing right now, okay. When people get short of breath and they start to use their neck muscles and their chest muscles, very often we wind up hunched forward, kind of hunched over like this. This tightens these chest muscles and the back muscles get loose, right? They become floppy and they don't become good. So one thing, if that's you, one thing you could do, if you just let your hands hang down with your thumbs facing forward, just turn your thumbs backwards and look what happens to my chest. Just by turning my thumbs from the front to the back. And what I'm doing here is I'm stretching the muscles on the front of my chest, opening these up. And what happens with a lot of people is their intercostal muscles either become too tight or too loose. And that also affects the mechanics of breathing. So intercostal muscles means inter, in between, costal means ribs. And if you have COPD or an obstructive disease, okay, when we talk about obstructive disease, we mean that you have difficulty blowing air out. And that means that you wind up with bigger lungs. And instead of your ribs being at a 45 degree angle, they become horizontal. And that's like you took a long car ride with your arm stretched all the way back like this, right? Doesn't feel good. And then when you need to get out, you got to do something to kind of get it going again. And when you have restrictive disease, something like pulmonary fibrosis or kyphosis or things like that, instead of your ribs being like this, your ribs are like this. And so instead of your intercostals being all the way stretched out like this, it's like taking the car ride with your arms squeezed together like this. Neither one is the most efficient. The most efficient is middle range. And these types of things, you know, it's not like we're going to undo 65 years worth of bad posture in 10 minutes per day. It means that as you're sitting here and doing this, okay, as you're watching this, you're periodically bringing your shoulders back, you're opening your chest. Anything where your body is going up and out is good for breathing in. Anything where your body is coming down and in is good for breathing out. So a lot of people say, well, I get short of breath when I bend over to tie my shoes, right? Why? It's because that's the time where you're supposed to be blowing out. So you can set up for that by breathing in at the times where your body's coming up and then blowing out at the times when your body should naturally squeeze. And think of it like an accordion. So when the accordion is squeezing, that's when you're blowing out. Flexibility exercise, strength, cardio. I think that Tai Chi and Qigong are great. I think that yoga is great. I think that meditation is great. All those things are in boot camp. Again, not a plug, but they're all there. Try them out. And then, you know, what we do is every day we do four different things. So we have Patricia. What's going on there? You getting tired? Give yourself a little smack in the face. We got only another 4 hours. You'll be okay. So the thing is, hang on, Deborah. I see you. I'm going to get to you. Don't worry. But the thing is that, you know, this is what boot camp is. So there's an intro to the day, okay, which is basically me usually at 4 or 5 in the morning, okay, rambling about something and introducing you to the day. There's thoughts and motivations, which are, you know, just different thoughts, ideas, motivation. Maybe it's a poem, maybe it's a piece of art, maybe it's a saying that I want you to try to incorporate into your day. Then we have BBFS, which is breathing, balance, flexibility, and strength. And then we have the walkabouts. And the walkabouts are cardio. And you don't have to have a treadmill. You don't have to have a field outside. You can do this walking in place, but they're virtual tours that we shot ourselves all over the world. And it's beautiful imagery and music. And it works 42 days, 6 weeks. And that's that. But again, back to exercise. It doesn't matter, okay? If you go to rehab, great. If you can't go to rehab, that's okay. Find something you could do at home. I have a book. This is not a plug. It's also available for free. If you don't like the book, don't ask me for your money back. It's free. If you like the book, leave a good review. If you don't like the book, recommend it to 10 of your enemies. But here's the idea. All this is in the book. So you can read it for free. There's tons of webinars everywhere. It's 8:05. I want to open this up to questions, okay, about exercise. Please don't make it so specific that it only applies to you and the creaky staircase that you have leading from your kitchen to your attic. But let's talk, and I'm happy to talk for an hour and answer questions. Go.
Elizabeth first.
Elizabeth first. Elizabeth, you're first, Beth said, but you're muted.
Okay, I got it. I think you can hear me now.
Yep.
What about when you are having an exacerbation? Do you still exercise, but just a little less so, not intense? Or because, like, yeah, when you have an exacerbation, basically.
Great question. The answer is definitely maybe. Okay. And I'll tell you what the factors are. Number one, you have to ask your doctor. You know, I'm going to say this. Ask your doctor, is it safe for you to exercise, right? Because so for those of you that don't know, an exacerbation is when your lung condition generally gets worse, right? For some reason, it could be that you have an infection. It could be that you have, you know, something or other, some type of inflammation. And sometimes we don't know the reason. Sometimes the reason is unknown. Okay.
Or like change of weather.
Change of weather could do it. You could be that you had an exposure to a chemical, like you walk by the perfume aisle in Lord and Taylor, or something like that. But sorry, I kid Lord and Taylor, they're out of business anyway. They're probably not going to sue me for that. But the idea is that you feel worse, right? Like something has changed. And very often people think, oh, my lungs got worse. Or people say, you know what? There's people who say that, you know what? Every time you have an exacerbation, you lose lung function. And people say, oh, this is the end of it. Now I'm getting worse. It kind of
puts you backwards a little bit.
Well, it does put you backward. It sets you back, but it doesn't have to be permanent, right?
No.
And so to answer your question, I say maybe because there's times during an exacerbation or illness when it's okay to exercise, and there's times where you shouldn't be doing any exercise at all. Now, there's no absolutes, right? I'm going to tell you some generalizations of how I think about it. Obviously, if you're very sick, if you have a fever, if you're producing a lot of mucus or something like that, that's not the time to be going up and doing the treadmill or to go out and take a 5-mile hike. But it could be a time to do some breathing exercises, right? It could be a time to just gently do some active little exercise in your bed. The general way I think about illness and exercise is this. When you get sick, there's kind of a time where you're going down and you're falling. You're getting worse. That's not the time that I think you should exercise. In my opinion, that's the time when you should be healing and saving and conserving all of your energy for, for fighting the infection, for whatever it is that is going to get you better and not let you get as sick. Right. So that's not the time to be doing anything overexertional. But let's say you have mucus in your lungs. Let's say you have pneumonia or you have a cold or you have the flu and mucus is a problem for you. Then doing some breathing exercises, doing the aerobica, doing the acapella, doing the incentive spirometer, these things can actually help you not get as bad, or they can actually help you clear the secretions and the infection faster. Okay. Then as you start to turn the corner and you start to get better, then you can very gently, okay, add exercise back in. But again, don't start where you were before the exacerbation. Start back, go back very, very gently and little by little by little by little, increase the time, increase the intensity, increase the strenuous nature and the type of exercise that you do, but also make sure that you're relying on your instruments. So look at your pulse oximeter, look at your heart rate, look at your oxygen saturation. Very often people ask, they get a very standard prescription for oxygen. It'll say 2 liters at rest, 4 liters with exercise. But for some people, that's not enough, right? For some people, that's not enough with exercise. Some people need 10 liters with exercise. So that's the kind of situation in which you rely on your instruments, okay? Pilots do that. Scuba divers do that, right? Because when you're at 20,000 feet, air looks like air. You don't know how high or low you are. That's why you need an altimeter. When you're underwater, when you're 200 feet down, water looks like water. So that's why you need a depth gauge. And when you don't know about oxygen, okay, and you can have very good oxygen and your saturation can be fine and you could still be very short of breath. And if that's the case, then you don't necessarily need more oxygen, but your oxygen can be low and maybe you're not that short of breath. But if your oxygen is low, even if you're not short of breath, we still need to rely and trust the instrument and we need to supplement oxygen. So the answer is, should you exercise when you're sick? I would say the more sick you are, the more gentle the exercise has to be. And sometimes if you're really in the throes of it, then you shouldn't be doing any exercise. You should be taking your medicines. You should be doing a little bit of breathing exercise every hour, and you should be sleeping and resting so your body has the energy to utilize to get better.
Bandit, no. Bandit, off.
What's Bandit doing? What is Bandit doing? Is he misbehaving?
No.
What?
A question?
Yep, go for it.
So, so physiologically, my oximeter tells me that I'm at 98-97% oxygenation, okay?
Right.
I feel like I feel like Biggie, what's his face, is in my room.
Biggie Smalls?
Behind you. So then they said, well, you don't need oxygen. But I walk around with this. I don't know if it's placebo or whatever, but I have developed into a very anxious person, and And the more anxious I get, the more short of breath I get.
Right.
I do take now an anti-anxiety drug, which helps. But I think that not only have I become deconditioned, I'm totally confused about the numbers don't go with the rest of me.
Right. So remember before I said that breathing is multifactorial. Now, first and foremost, okay, after the year and a half that we all just had, right, if you weren't somewhat anxious, I would be worried about you. I would be like, what's wrong with you? Why aren't you anxious? You in particular, Peggy, who, if I may, I talk a little bit about you.
Of course.
So Peggy had a very, very severe case of COVID, which she managed at home. Okay. And I could have very easily made the case that she should have been in a hospital, but we didn't want her to go to a hospital, right? Because we're in New York City. And the fact of the matter is that you could get sicker if you go to a hospital. And we didn't want people winding up on vents where they never come off a vent. She managed at home and you got through it, right? So you went through a very traumatic experience. And if this wasn't anxiety provoking, I mean, it's perfectly normal that this would be anxiety provoking for you. Now let's start and take this apart one piece at a time. If your oxygen is 98%, right, but you still feel short of breath, how is that possible?
Well, let's say I'm going from here to my gym, my bedroom, which is 10, 15, 20 steps away, right?
Right.
And I'm walking there slowly and I feel short of breath. Like I have to do my personal breathing.
Right. That's right. That's exactly right. But your oxygen is good, right?
Yeah.
Now, if you took your oxygen off, would it still be the same? And I'm not just talking to Peggy. Everybody else can be asking themselves the same question because this is a non-universal experience. A lot of people have the same exact experience, right? So if you took your oxygen off, would it still remain the same?
Yes.
Okay. So what that's telling us is that there has to be something else besides your oxygen saturation that's making you short of breath. Right. What could it be?
I'm not hallucinating. I don't think.
Right. You're not hallucinating, but it's not the oxygen. It's the mechanics of breathing. It's the airway mechanics. Right. So when you have COPD, what that means is that you have an obstruction to exhalation, and the harder and faster you breathe, the harder and faster it becomes to breathe, because the harder and faster you blow out, the more bronchospasm you get and the tighter and tighter your airways get. And that stacks up and it becomes cumulatively progressive, right? So if you think about a pulmonary function test, what happens first? They say, take a breath in and then blow it all the way out slowly, right? And that's called your SVC or your VC, your slow vital capacity. And then they ask you to take that same breath in and blow out as hard and as fast as you can. And the reason for that is because that is going to elicit the obstruction, right? That is going to call out the obstruction, and that's going to cause the airway trapping and the bronchospasm. And that's the very nature of COPD. So if you think about it like this, we're all in a movie theater and I say to you, fire, and everybody runs for the exit, right? What happens? We all run at the same time. And we start to get this backflow, right? We start to get this obstruction because all these people are trying to barrel out through the exit at once. But if I say, everybody, I smell a little gas, okay? Wasn't the bean burrito that I ate for lunch, okay? Sorry, I had to, I apologize. But they come to me, I have no choice. God puts them in my brain and I have to say them. That's why I have to work for myself. I get fired from every job where I work for anybody else. But here's the thing, okay? If we file out gently, right? Single file, well, then we have a nice flow of people walking out. And that's exactly the point behind pursed lip breathing, right? Because what pursed lip breathing does is it creates, if we try to go, that's why when your physical therapist or respiratory therapist or nurse or anybody else says to you, smell the flowers and blow out the candles, you can say to them, you may not understand completely what you're doing for the simple reason that blowing out your candles is how you're going to get more obstruction, right? Because blowing out your candles is that same maneuver where we ask you to blow out hard and fast. And that's that same maneuver that causes bronchospasm and airway obstruction. So when you hear somebody saying, smell the flowers, blow out the candles, I say, hey, that person doesn't really, they're actually doing you a disservice, right? And what you should be doing instead is taking that breath in, and it's like cooling the soup on the spoon. You don't even have to blow. Just create a little space and let that air come out gently. If you have an obstructive disease, okay? Restrictive disease is a little bit different. So pursed-lip breathing doesn't always work for people with restrictive disease. But the thing is that for obstructive disease, it definitely works. So Peggy, the answer to your question, and Beth, if you could put in the chat or also in the group later, you know, the oxygen manifestos, I wrote three articles called Oxygen Manifesto, and it talks about exactly this. It talks about my oxygen is 99%. Why am I still short of breath? Right. And it's the mechanics of breathing. And that's where the medications come in. That's where learning the breathing techniques come in. And over time, if you do the right exercises and the right workouts, you know, we utilize exercise not just to make you stronger or to make you breathe better, but also to relax those airways, right? So it's like you have smooth muscle inside your airways. And a lot of people don't realize this, but that muscle can get tight and loose, tight and loose. So how many people have the experience where they feel fine in their home, and the second they step out into the cold, it's like they get this big squeeze, right? That's because your airways are contracting and constricting and going into spasm. So if you think about, like, let's say you were an athlete in high school and you're exercising on a cold day, it takes more time for you to warm up. And the way that you warm up this smooth muscle that's in your airways is not by taking a giant breath in. It's by breathing in for two, breathing out for two, breathing in for two, breathing out for two. Do that 10 times. Then as that gets easier, breathe in for three, blow out for three, breathe in four. And that's the same thing as stretching a little more and a little more and a little more. And over time, as you do this, your body will pick it up and you eventually will become looser. It's like yoga for your airways. We're putting four things in the chat. One is Oxygen Manifesto number one, Oxygen Manifesto two, Oxygen Manifesto three. They're all about the devices. They're all about when you should and shouldn't. And in this, if there's also a webinar, it's a 2-hour webinar about how you should use oxygen. And while we're on the subject of oxygen and exercise, I don't care how much oxygen it takes. You don't lower your workout because your oxygen goes down, okay? Because then you're being limited by your oxygen. So I would rather give you as much oxygen as you need in order to maintain that saturation and push you to a higher workout, because it's that higher workout that will actually improve your lung function over time. So when people say to me, oh, you know what, pulmonary rehab doesn't improve your lung function, I'm like, okay, because I know what you're doing and you don't know what I'm doing. Or people say, you're working these patients too hard. And I'm like, no, we're not working them too hard. We're working them how hard they're supposed to be working in order to improve lung function. Or they'll say, well, you know, we really should be walking slow and long, but that doesn't help you. Again, if this is what your life requires and we exercise you down here, doesn't help you to walk slow and long. So again, by any means necessary, whatever it takes, your oxygen going down shouldn't tell you that you have to stop the exercise. It's like if every time the baby cries, you give it a bottle, you know, it never learns to stop crying. If it cries and you go in and you punch it, no, I'm kidding. I kid the babies. That's why I'm not a parent, because I would probably beat my kids. I know it. That's why I'm not a parent. But the idea is that we want to train the body to do things, and your body doesn't know that you're wearing oxygen, right? Your body doesn't know that we're giving you 6 liters of oxygen. Your body only knows that we're asking it to do more, and it will make that adaptation. And a lot of people think, well, you know, I don't want to become addicted to oxygen, right? We're all addicted to oxygen from breath one to our last breath, okay? And using more during exercise doesn't mean that it's not more, okay? Now, if you say, I don't want to get addicted to heroin, that's different, okay? Then I'm going to advise you not to touch it. But with oxygen, using oxygen during exercise and exertion doesn't mean that you become addicted to it. It doesn't mean that you're going to need more of it. It doesn't mean that you're going to need it longer. You're not doing yourself any disservice. You're actually doing yourself a huge service. And the medications are the same, right? So the bronchodilators also, that's not the treatment. Although in some cases it is the treatment because it does help with the airways and it does help open your lungs. But you can use that as a tool to get the best workout and to get the most activity out of yourself. And it's that exercise and activity that's ultimately going to improve your lung function. A lot of times when we talk about rescue inhalers, right, people get this idea. It's like they almost think of it like in case of emergency, break glass, right? And that's when you take your albuterol. But think about it. When you get to that point, when you're like, how effective do you think the albuterol is going to be? Not very effective because you're so short of breath that it's not going to get into your lungs where it could help you. So if you know that by walking to the grocery store, when you get to block two, that is going to, thank you, Doris, for demonstrating. Doris is like my Vanna White. She just showed us the spacer to use with your inhaler. Okay. Thank you, Vanna. But the idea is that if you know that walking up the hill from 34th to 35th makes you short of breath, then 15 minutes before, thank you, Susan, for also showing the spacer. Everyone who has a spacer, hold up their spacers. We're at the concert. We don't hold up our lighters. We hold up our spacers, right? We're at the breathing concert. But the idea is that it's okay to take your medication 15 minutes before so that you're, all right, we know when we go out, we're going to get some bronchoconstriction. But if I start here inside and then I use my bronchodilator 15 minutes before and I go to here, well, bronchoconstriction gets me back to where I was before and I'm still okay. And, you know, please talk to your doctors about this and different strategies that you can use, because some doctors are like 2 liters at rest and 4 liters at this, and you should only take your albuterol if this, that, the other thing. But these are all tools, right? So it's like if you know, you want to be prepared for the elements. And if you know that you have something that you can do and you have something at your disposal, that's very reassuring to you. And that takes a lot of that anxiety out of the equation, because we know that when you're short of breath, it's like a lot of people, you know, you get that shortness of breath. It's like Fred Sanford. It's like, Elizabeth, I think it's the big one, you know? And it's like, the idea is that maybe it is, maybe it's not, but let's find out what it is. And don't let fear be your guidance. Don't let your mind set the limit before your body does it. And don't let the things that you cannot do interfere with the things that you can do. Other questions?
Which webinar?
There's one, I think it's in Oxygen Manifesto. There's a link to it. It's called Oxygen All. Hold on. Let me see if I can.
Okay. I can. I can do it.
Dr. Greenspan.
Yes.
There is such a thing as over-oxygenation. At what point?
Oh, I love this one. Know? I knew you were coming. I knew you were coming because you come every time, not you personally, but everybody talks about this. So why do you think there's such a thing as over oxygenation?
Because I think I did it to myself and ended up in the hospital because of it.
Okay. So I just posted the thing. Okay. I just posted it. Who's talking first of all?
Louise Hobden.
Okay. Is your camera on? No.
Yes.
Right? It is. Where are you? Let me see you.
Well, on my screen, I'm upper right.
I see her.
Louise, let me see. Let me see you.
Keep talking, Louise, and it lights
oh, no,
up.
No. Richard okay. Oh, I see you. Oh, well, that explains it. No, I'm just kidding. Okay.
Because I'm so white? I can't adjust my light. Sorry.
No. I was not referring to your whiteness. I am the whitest on earth. If I get a good tan, I am flesh color. So I would not be the one to make fun of you for being the whitest. I'm just joking. There was nothing about you that made me say that other than my own irreverent sense of humor. But here's the thing. So I'm going to tell you what you're talking about, and I'm going to put it in a way that everybody understands, and I'm going to tell you what the fear is based on, and then I'm going to tell you why it may or may not be accurate, okay? There are certain people with COPD, obstructive disease, who have difficulty blowing air out that are what we call CO2 retainers, right? Is that you, yeah. Louise? Does that yes. ring a bell? Okay. So there are basically three things that send a signal to our brain to breathe. A lot of people think it's when our oxygen goes down, that sends a signal to breathe, right? But in fact, before our oxygen goes down, it's our carbon dioxide going up, right? It's a change in pH, which is an increase in hydrogen ion in our blood, which means that the blood becomes more acidic, and then it's a drop in oxygen, right? Now, when it comes to people with COPD who are CO2 retainers, because they can't blow all the air out, what winds up happening is that they have abnormally high levels of carbon dioxide chronically, right? And the thing is that their bodies get used to having these high levels of carbon. Oh, that was nice. Elizabeth got a kiss. I think honey's going to sleep. He's going to sleep or he just got home. Which is it? That was cute. All right. So here's the thing, right? So if I were to go like this and put my finger near your eye every time, right, that would be really annoying. But if I did it all day, every day, you'd eventually get used to it, right? So on an acute level, if the body's CO2 goes up, I get a message to breathe, 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 breathe. But if my CO2 is chronically high because I can't blow all the air out of my lungs, some people believe that you no longer respond to an increase in CO2. I told you that's your prime mover before. And some people believe that, well, you know, this is happening so frequently that it no longer annoys me. I'm not even aware of it. It's like white noise. And then people believe that you have what's called hypoxic drive. And what that means is that they think that instead of responding to CO2 going up, it means that you respond to low oxygen. And that's what drives your breathing from this point forward. And they believe that if they give you that oxygen, that shuts off your hypoxic drive and you stop breathing. Okay? That's the idea behind it. That's the theory behind it. Okay?
Now, that's exactly what happened. I did stop breathing.
Okay. So let me talk about that for a second. So every time we talk about this, there's somebody who says, well, you know what? You're wrong. And don't worry, Louise. This is not an argument. I'm just speaking frankly. Somebody says, you're wrong because I used too much oxygen and I wound up in the hospital, right? I can't say if that did or didn't happen to you, right? I don't know. And it's very possible that you went to the hospital and your CO2 was very high and your doctors or the people there said, hey, guess what? You know, you used too much oxygen and that's why your CO2 was very high. But maybe your CO2 was very high for a different reason. And that triggered kind of a whole cascade of other things. Now, that being said, I'm not saying if you're, you know, and again, these are things you should talk about with your doctor, okay? But I think it's important to say that, well, you know, can I use increased oxygen at certain times? So if you were to say to me, I'm a CO2 retainer and you wear oxygen while you sleep, I would say, make sure you use a very low dose of oxygen, right? I'm not saying that it's impossible that if you use 6 liters per minute while you sleep, that you might not stop breathing. It's not my spot because enough people have told me that this has happened that I would never say, Louise, you know what? You're full of it. That's BS. You're wrong. You don't know what you're talking about. Your doctors are all wrong. I'm right. Okay. I do often feel that way, but I would never say that to you. But the idea is that, like people say to me, like when I say use as much oxygen as you need, right, during exercise, I know you're not going to stop breathing while you're walking on the treadmill. You know how I know? Because you're walking on the treadmill. And even if you were to stop breathing, you know what I would do? I would go like this. I would go, hey, Louise, take a breath. That's it. And it would be over. Okay. I'm going to tell you something. And again, I speak mostly from my own experience. Okay. So if I tell you something, it means I've done it myself or seen it myself. Not that I read it or I heard it from someone else or I saw it at a conference. I've worked 30 years in cardiopulmonary rehab, 20 years in EMS. I've never seen somebody get into trouble because they got too much oxygen. I've only seen people get into trouble because they didn't have enough. Okay. Now, that being said, if you have COPD and you're a CO2 retainer, then you have to have that conversation with your doctor. And I'm not going to take a chance. I'm not going to be like, well, Louise, try it. Maybe you'll stop breathing. Maybe you won't. Okay. It's not my place to do that. Okay. But I'd say certainly if you're exercising, and certainly if you're exercising with a therapist next to you or a trainer or anybody, even your, you know, could be anybody. It could be Bobby from down the block, the paper boy. If he's standing next to you and you turn up the oxygen so that you can maintain saturation, just say, Bobby, listen, if I stop breathing, tap me on the shoulder and tell me to take a breath. And the reason why I say that is because a lot of doctors will say, well, you know what? I only want you to be at 88%. I want you to keep your oxygen at 88%, right? Because I don't want you. But let me show you why I don't agree.
I was told 88 to 92.
Okay. I like 93% plus. Okay. Now I'm going to show you why. Oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. Okay. So okay, so let me show you something which is called the oxy. Please, Susan, don't write this down, okay? It's called the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve, right?
Okay.
And this has to do with your oxygen saturation, right? So look at this right here. This is 90% right here, right? I don't know who these girls are that are trying to get my attention. It happens to me all the time. It's frustrating that they try to present me with salads, with eggs. Anyway, but here's the idea. This is 90%. This is 100%, right? And you see how it's kind of flat over here? So this over here is 88%. This over here is 85%, right? So if you look at this, there's actually a bigger difference going from 92 to 88 than there is going from 90 to 100, right? And the way I describe this is like, let's say we're at the Grand Canyon. And you're 10 feet away from the Grand Canyon and you want me to take your photo, right? You can walk back anywhere in those 10 feet and you're good. But if you walk that 11th foot, we got a situation here, right? And it's the same thing with oxygen saturation, which is that, you know, if you're in the 90s, you're pretty good. But again, that 90% mark, which is equivalent to a partial pressure of 60, that's where things start changing very, very quickly. And again, I'm not telling you you should increase your oxygen. What I'm telling you is that, you know, sometimes people get the idea like it's like, oh my God, my oxygen's at 3. And then they go, let me stop breathing. It's not like that. Okay. It's not like that. It happens over time. So if you're pretty healthy, you're not having an exacerbation, you're not short of breath, I don't see why you can't stay at 92 or 93 or 94. And especially when you're exercising, right? Sleep is a little different. I wouldn't put my money on sleep per se, because guess what? You're asleep. You theoretically could stop breathing. People have apnea. People have other things going on. It's not impossible. So if, you know, but again, this is something that's kind of been talked about, debunked, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, again, I think it's a conversation to have. I'm not showing any disrespect for what you said. I'm not saying it's impossible that you got too much oxygen and wound up in the hospital. It's just not my experience. And I've seen thousands and thousands of patients, and I think it's old thinking. But the risks are high. So if that's what you think and your doctors think, hey, by the way, well, that's why we're dressed alike. We're both in red shirts, but let me ask you this. How much oxygen did you use? Can you just tell me a little bit about the situation? Like, did you increase your oxygen?
It was the day after I came home from the hospital when I was first put on oxygen, and I was told 2 liters.
Right.
Okay.
They said, Louise, whatever you do, don't eat more than 2 cookies. How many did you have? How many cookies did you have?
I had 5.
You turned it up to 5?
In a very short period of time, because I felt a little short of breath. And I said, well, maybe I'll just go to 3. And then 3 felt pretty good. So I thought, well, if 3 feels pretty good, how much will 5 feel?
She's a victim.
So I went up to five. Can I get an
amen here for this? Okay. Can I get an amen?
Because there was no education. Nobody told me anything. Right.
Okay. So there's So let's talk about oxygen for a second.
So that made me pass out.
Okay. Let me play devil's advocate for a second. Okay. Maybe that made you pass out. So you were using a concentrator, right?
Yes.
And you were using a nasal cannula.
Yes.
Okay. So what were you in the hospital for? Pneumonia?
No, because my husband found me on the kitchen floor and called 911.
Okay.
I died in the emergency room.
Okay.
They had to resuscitate because I had no medical directives. I was intubated and I was on a ventilator.
Okay. I'm going to just talk out loud right now. I'm going to make the case that, hey, maybe you shouldn't have been discharged. Maybe you weren't ready for discharge.
Oh, I was not.
Okay. So it's possible that you were home and you got into trouble for another reason, right? Because I see this a lot, especially on an ambulance where you give somebody oxygen and people think they're going to stop breathing and they go, even though they're in critical condition, eventually their breathing pattern adapts to it and they come up. Okay. So in my opinion, not my opinion, my experience. Okay. And it doesn't mean that my experience is universal and that it means the same for everybody, but it sounds to me like there were other factors at play. Okay. But just for a point of perspective, the air has 20.96% oxygen in it, right? Like where we are, we're round up to 21%.
Yeah.
When you're using oxygen with a nasal cannula, every liter that you go up, continuous oxygen raises it by about 4%. So in your situation, let's say if you weren't wearing oxygen, you'd be breathing in 21%. At 1 liter, you're breathing in 25%. At 2 liters, you're breathing in 29%. At 3 liters, you're breathing in 33%, 37%, 41% at 5 liters, right? Is it likely that that would have caused you to stop breathing? I don't know. I mean, I would make the case that probably something was wrong that raised your CO2 high, that because what your body was doing wasn't adequate. In other words, you weren't adequately removing CO2. Now, again, I'm just speaking out loud. I'm telling you my thoughts. It doesn't mean I'm right. I could be completely wrong.
Okay? So after 2 days on the ventilator,
yep.
The doctors decided that they needed to take me off the ventilator because they, said in cases of COPD, if you're on a ventilator too long, your lungs get lazy and you never come off.
Okay, another misconception,
so
right?
So my husband heard two doctors arguing, which never should have happened. One said she needs to come off the ventilator, and one said she's not ready. The doctor said that I needed to come off won the argument.
Right.
They took me off the ventilator. The other doctor was right. I was not ready.
Right, that's right.
It took them an hour and a half to get me back on the ventilator.
Right. And then how long after you came off the ventilator did you go home?
10 days. I was on another 2 days. So I was on a ventilator for 4 days.
Okay. So again, I'm not disputing. Okay. I'm not saying that, but it sounds like you were in critical condition. And to me, 10 days is not enough time for you to go home by yourself. Now, I'm not saying it was a good idea to say, well, if 2 is good, 5's better, right?
I never should have come home.
You don't get a genius award for that, Louise, but 10 days after you're on a ventilator, I would have liked you to go to rehab.
And I want to tell you that I 110% will tell anybody, anytime, pulmonary rehab saved my life.
But how long were you in rehab for?
3 days a week, 2 hours.
Oh, but you're talking about outpatient. But you're talking about outpatient rehab.
And I am still going twice a week, 10 years later.
Yeah, That okay, so you're talking about outpatient rehab after you went home, right?
There was no rehab in the hospital.
And he was always on COVID. Now he's back on his regular.
Back on my regular, talking about cardiopulmonary right now.
And I've done your boot camp during COVID when there was no pulmonary rehab at my hospital. And I have to tell you, I love it.
Louise, don't think you're getting any endorsement money out of this right
now.
Well, I appreciate it, but just listen for 1 second, Louise. I want to just tell you one thing. I'm not talking about outpatient pulmonary rehab, right? If you are a patient who was on a ventilator, two doctors duke it out to decide, should you be on the ventilator, should you not be on the ventilator? Now, there's no difference between 2 days on a ventilator and 7 days on a ventilator. What it does is it gives your body a chance to rest and recover, right? Without working so hard to breathe. So you were intubated, you were extubated, and then you had to be almost immediately intubated again, right? So to me, you're not the person who should be home anytime soon by yourself. You should be going to inpatient rehab, and I want a good 10 to 14 days of you showing that you're stable before you go home. And if that had happened, even if you would have turned the oxygen up to 15, I don't think you would have had the same situation. It sounds to me like you were in critical condition. This is just my opinion again, you know, but it sounds like you went home too fast and you got into a jam. Other questions?
Noah, okay. Can I ask a question now? It's the Bora.
Yes. It's up. Really, Beth is the boss. So if Beth says it's okay, then yeah.
Beth, may I ask a question?
I'm just kidding. I'm the boss. You can ask it. Go ahead.
Oh, okay.
I don't like to tell Beth that too much, but go ahead.
I'm so deconditioned that I have not yet started the boot camp. However, I am doing a set of respiratory muscle exercises that I found on YouTube.
Okay.
That are so, the woman is a respiratory therapist who not only explains the exercises, but she demonstrates them with the breathing. And I'm doing
it. Donna Wilson?
No, it's Lorraine Martinelli Reed.
Okay,
and, I don't know who she is, and when you did the exercise where you were showing about opening up the chest by putting your thumbs backwards, tilting backwards, those are among the exercises that I've been doing. And what I'm basically trying to do is work my way up to where I can really tolerate the boot camp because I'm extremely deconditioned.
Okay,
and so right now I'm getting up and like doing steps beside the bed and these respiratory exercises.
But that's part of boot camp, Deborah. That's part of boot camp. Boot camp starts very early. Okay. Very light. The first day is only 4 minutes of walking. You can do it with your walker in front of you. If you need to, you could take steps in place. And I say to you, if you can't walk for 4 minutes, walk for 2 minutes and 2 minutes. If you can't walk for 2 minutes, do a minute and a minute and a minute and a minute. I'm not telling you not to do anybody's exercise. If something works for you, keep doing it, but you are ready for boot camp. Boot camp was specifically made for people like you in mind, and you're not too deconditioned for boot camp. Just go at your own pace. Take it nice and easy. Take breaks. You don't have to do it all at once.
Okay. Okay.
But you're ready for boot camp.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Also, I'm opening a new center soon. So
I'm looking forward to that. Right. My status has changed.
It's going to be $500 a visit, Deborah, so start saving
well,
now.
Well, if you can get it out of Medicaid, you can have it, kiddo, because I'm in that situation of having
You're like, I'll take you. We'll figure something out for you. Other questions? Other questions?
No, that was it. I do highly recommend.
Well, I meant other people, Deborah. Person. I meant other people. Okay. Oh. There's other people here. That reminds me, there was a skit on Saturday Night Live. Look it up. It's called Hello Trudy. And it was this radio show. And they only had one caller. Her name was Trudy. So eventually they just named the show and they'd be like, Hello Trudy. This is called Hello Deborah. Deborah, could I get you a glass of water? Anything? A snack? We're good? All right.
Other questions? I have a question.
Yes.
When are you going to open the center and where and how do we sign?
Who is this?
Oh, yeah.
I have to make sure before I tell you where it is.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of women trying to find out where I am on different days. I hope if all goes well, it's going to be at 6 East 39th Street, which is between 5th and Madison. And if my construction goes well, there's going to be a soft opening in December, but for sure, 2022, January 1 or 2.
It'll be like the old one with the really? Machines and the cardio machines.
It's going to be a little different. It's going to be a little different. It's going to be a little more exclusive, kind of like the speakeasy. It's like, you know, rails. You know, what?
Seriously.
No, I'm being serious.
He is.
I'm being serious because my team is dispersed and it's not going to, it's when I say it's not going to be for everybody, like, again, my focus is going to be on super complex patients. And it's going to be, not to say you can't get in, but it's not going to be like unlimited. You know, Rao's, the Italian restaurant up in Harlem.
Yeah. Yes.
It's going to be like that. So you're going to have to know like a senator or a congressman to get into this rehab center. So
Noah, can we do it sort of in order of these people that have been waiting the longest?
Yes. As a matter of Joan, fact, I don't know who they are.
Beth, I do. I do. I'm watching. It goes Joan, Elizabeth, Christopher. And then I see the rest and I'll name them. But Joan,
how are you finding this out?
I just know. I'll tell you later.
Is it the hands?
Yep. But I watched them go up first.
Okay, good, good. Joan. Beth, you really are the boss. I was just kidding before.
I was going to say, I can't even mute myself. How can I be the boss?
What do you mean you can't mute yourself?
I have no control there. Not kidding.
You mean you can't stop talking? I know that about you. All right, just kidding. Next, Joan, Kellett.
Joan. Kellett,
go for it.
Sorry, I know. My hand was raised from one of your previous questions. I'm really listening to what you have, so I'll let
you know. You were going to say out. From one of my previous lectures. I was going to say that's
go like for fun. It, Elizabeth.
Thanks, no, that's so Joan. Fun. Joan didn't finish. Joan didn't finish.
No?
Oh. Joan. Joan? Who said their hand was raised from a previous question? Oh.
It was Joan, but she's gone. I keep asking her to unmute, but she's not.
Yeah.
There you are, Joan. Yes. Go for it.
I said my hand was raised from a previous question that Noah had asked. So I want other people to go. I don't have a question. I'm finding this very interesting. Thank you, Noah.
Thank you, Joan.
Nice going,
Elizabeth.
I'm just kidding. Good. Next.
You were talking about raising it up to where you need it versus, you know, doing an exercise that wouldn't quite make it so that you could do the higher level of daily activity. And you said to turn, you know, you could turn it up as high as you need it to get to that level. Now, that sounds great for when you're doing the exercise. If I am, my normal activity is at that level, how am I going to do it at that level where I can't have it on 15 or 10 or higher than my 5?
You mean because your machine only goes to 5?
Well, my home one, right, goes to 6. Now, I do have some e-tanks. And I realized that if I need it, I can go to that. I have not been able to get to that intensity yet. I have a bike. I do not have a treadmill, but I'm assuming a bike is good.
Bike is great.
Just as good because I can intensify it and make it a little harder to pedal. I don't know where my heart rate should be, but you said to get a full workup. So I'm going to work on getting a full workup.
Yeah, so it should be EKG, echocardiogram, and, you know, ideally stress echo. But, you know, again, a mistake that I think a lot of people make is they do a stress echo with a treadmill and they, you don't really get enough of a hemodynamic response. So you could ask your pulmonologist and cardiologist to speak, and maybe they would do like what's called a pharmacologic test, where they give you medicine and then do the echocardiogram. But what I wanted to say also in response to what you said is that a couple of things, and this is all in the oxygen manifestos, and it's also in the webinar. There's a big difference between continuous oxygen and pulsed oxygen, right?
Yes.
If you have one of those portable pulsed units, then those numbers are generally not liters per minute, right? Those numbers are settings, and that means that a six on your Inogen is not 6 liters per minute, okay?
Yeah, I'm talking about my portable only goes up to four.
Okay, so
but the your home portable, goes
up your portable, six. But your portable does not go up to 4 liters per minute, okay?
Right.
Your
right.
portable may go up to a setting of four, and depending upon what machine you have, it's going to be significantly less than 4 liters per minute. So when we talk about liters per minute, we're only talking about continuous oxygen. And here's another trick, okay, especially because some people only have concentrators that go up. You know, there are 10 liter per minute concentrators, right? And you can ask your doctor for those. But here's something else. Once you're, once 6 liters of oxygen on a cannula does not keep you saturated, a very easy trick, switch to a non-rebreather mask. And that will significantly raise the concentration of oxygen that you're getting. So as an example,
non-rebreather mask.
Non-rebreather, that's the mask that has the bag on it, right? And, then you can go up to 15 liters or even 10 liters on a mask is a significantly higher concentration than, you know, 10 liters on a cannula is like useless. It's like if you want a drink and I give you a drink with a fire hose, right? Like only so much is going to get in your mouth. The rest is wasted. But I started this in 1995 when I started treating pulmonary fibrosis patients. And at that time, first of all, there was no treatment for pulmonary fibrosis. Second of all, everybody would say pulmonary fibrosis, you're too sick for rehab, right? Because they come in, their saturation would be low when they're sitting in their chair. Then they'd get up and it would be lower. Then they'd take a few steps and it would be lower. So you're too sick for rehab. But to me, too sick for rehab means go home and wait to die. So I had a great mentor named Horacio Pineda, and we didn't like this. And what we started doing was supplementing with as much oxygen as people needed, using a mask, and people got better with it. One other point I want to make is when I talked about relying on your instruments, right? And using your, you know, using your pulse oximeter to tell you, are you adequately saturated or not? And how much do you have? How much do you need? When can you change it? The best explanation I ever heard of this came from Norma Braun, who, in my opinion, is one of the greatest physicians ever on earth. And she described it like this. If you get chilly, you put on a sweater. And if it warms up and you get warm, you can take the sweater off. So utilize your instruments. And as you increase the intensity of the exercise, you may need a little more oxygen and as you come down, you may be able to lower it a little bit, but there's no harm in over oxygenating. You know, people talk about oxygen toxicity. That's not going to happen with any of the home equipment. It's impossible. Okay. That's like if you breathe 100% oxygen for weeks on end, that's not going to happen. There's a lot of myths around it. Unfortunately, there's a lot of people who kind of hear these buzzwords. And it's the basic physiology that they don't understand, but that basic physiology is the bread and butter. That's where it's all at. And if you understand
I guess I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I think what I mean though is if I need, say, seven, okay, to do an exercise that is a little bit higher intensity, maybe what the intensity would be had I been walking around picking up things, because those are things that make me breath, just picking up things and putting them away. Now, if I want to try to get to a point where I could be picking up these things, but stay on that 4 liters because I've improved things.
Yes.
By exercising.
Yes.
Now, that's fine at home. But when I do go out somewhere, just walking.
Right. So if you're going out and you need 7 liters of exercise, then you have no choice. You have to take a tank. That's the only thing that's going to work for you.
Okay.
So, and maybe what you could do is you could take a tank and you can,
I don't know how I'm supposed to do that by myself. you know, they, how do you carry extra tanks? Because if I'm on 4 liters, it's gone in 1.5 hours.
Yeah, no, I totally get it. And the thing is that, you know, for a lot of people, it's very hard to do. I only had one patient who ever did exactly what she needed. And she came from Brooklyn to Manhattan with 8 E10s. And she had, you know, I actually always have this idea to create like an actual device for people to carry these things. Maybe this year I'll do it. But
well, I mean, how do you get it out of the car? Because I was thinking, okay, if I get someone to put them all in the car for me, if I go to, say, the doctor's appointment, how do I get one of the extra ones? Or how do I carry two of them?
Here's what I would suggest. Here's what I would suggest. Think of this, right?
I need a hot man that just carries these things around with me.
Why does he have one of those? Why does he have to be hot? Why can't he just be a nice person and he carries around for you?
He's the bonus. He's the bonus.
The bonus is if he's hot and, you know, I'm single. So.
Let me just talk about this. Imagine if I said something like that.
I'm single. I need the hot one.
Okay. So.
He can be nice. He can be nice. Okay.
Imagine if I said something like this. Then I would be a sexist, a misogynist.
Call me a sexist. Sue me. Right. You won't get anything from someone.
Anyway, hang on a second. Take a breath while I tell you a suggestion. So here's a suggestion for you. You have a portable oxygen concentrator, right?
I have that and the E-tanks.
Okay. So here's how you're going to do it.
Portable because I bought it.
All right.
So if I'm just sitting.
Let's make a deal. Okay. Let's make a deal. I'm going to talk for a second. I need you to just not talk for 60 seconds.
Okay.
All right. Beth, if she tries to unmute herself, please mute her immediately. Just listen for a second, okay? And everybody listen to this. So let's say, think of it like that sweater analogy, right? Let's say your car, you could put the heat on, but you need the jacket to go from the car to the house, right? So do you walk with a walker by any chance? You can talk now. Go ahead, Elizabeth. Go ahead. No, just shake your head yes or no.
I have a rollator.
Perfect. So this is perfect. So here's what you do. Can you carry one E-tank in your rollator?
They're okay. Kind of big.
Here's an even better idea. There's smaller tanks, right? There's M-tanks, right?
Yes.
So you get two M-tanks and you get two regulators, right? So that you're not worrying about changing it. You could just switch your patio to one and you take your portable oxygen concentrator, right? So you get out to the car using your M tank. You get into the car, you go to the concentrator. You need to walk to the doctor's office. You get onto the M tank for the walk. Once you calm down, you go back on the portable concentrator.
I knew you could come up with an answer for me.
There you go.
That
so guys, when you're thinking of these answers, when you're getting these pearls of wisdom, think of the Pulmonary Wellness Foundation and take out your credit card and go to our website
and donate.
And make a donation, okay? Because I try to give you 99, you know, I try to give you $1,000 worth of game for $9.99. I don't even charge you.
That might make up for the guy.
That
become
might.
A monthly that supporter.
A become monthly a monthly sustainer. Supporter. That's right.
That's right.
That's right. All right. That's other questions.
Christopher, go ahead, Christopher.
See, that's a way to do it, right? Where there's ways to do it. And all that stuff will fit in your basket, right? And again, if you need to change, if you're somebody who needs to change tanks while you're out, it's worth your while to get a second regulator, because trust me, it's very panic inducing to be like, uh-oh, I only have 30 seconds left. You know, so get a second regulator. So that all you have to do is take your concentrator, take your cannula, put it in. We have -1 minute left. No, I'll give you another maximum 14 minutes. This is not my record. My record is over 3 hours, but keep it coming.
Okay. The pulmonary rehab course online. Is that good for people with interstitial lung disease?
Absolutely.
Same kind of treatment. I have COPD, and I've done the course. I think it's wonderful, by the way.
Thank you.
My wife has interstitial lung disease. I have the course also.
Yeah.
And I was curious if it was the same thing, just as beneficial.
Absolutely. Have to make sure you maintain good saturation, though. Usually people with interstitial lung disease will go a little bit lower, but absolutely. I mean, I treat, this is another thing that people say to me, they're like, well, that's not for interstitial lung disease. That's for COPD. Say, listen, I treat interstitial lung disease, COPD, pulmonary hypertension. It works for all. Okay. There's no division in the rehab between COPD and interstitial lung disease.
Okay, Rivka's next.
Hi.
Hi.
Yeah. So my question is, I have interstitial lung disease, as you know. So when you're talking about that breath that we do in the pulmonary function test,
yep.
Given that now we're retraining using the purse breath, which is really the opposite of that big breath that we have to take in the
right. Pulmonary,
how is it reasonable to expect that I'm going to see an improvement in the FEV and the FEV1 and the FVC because
so
of
that's
the
a great. So that's a great question. And when I said before that that restrictive lung disease is different than obstructive disease. So when you have obstructive disease, as I said, you have difficulty blowing air out, right? And what FVC is forced vital capacity. So that means from my deepest breath in to my fullest breath out. How much air is that? Now, about 85% of that should come out in the first second. That's what FEV1 is, right? Now, for people with obstructive disease, the ratio of FEV1 to FVC is down, right? Meaning that you get less out in the first second. It takes longer to eke that air out a little bit at a time because the tube is narrower. With restrictive disease, it's actually the opposite. So pursed lip breathing in restrictive lung disease doesn't serve the same benefit. It's not that it doesn't serve any benefit, but it doesn't push the airways open. It slows your breathing down. With restrictive or interstitial lung disease, the problem is not that you have difficulty blowing air out. It's that you have trouble taking that deep breath. And in fact, the air comes out even more quickly. So often with people with interstitial lung disease, you'll see a decrease in FEV1 and you'll see a decrease in FVC, but the ratio will actually be higher. So you'll often see people with restrictive disease having an FEV over FEV1 over FVC with an FEV1 over FVC of greater than 90%, because it's almost like, remember Jack LaLanne used to do that thing where he'd blow up a hot water bottle. So a hot water bottle is a great kind of representation of interstitial lung disease, which is that it's very hard to blow up, but then once you stop blowing, it closes shut like a mousetrap. So pursed lip breathing, the goal with interstitial lung disease is to slow the breathing down so you could take a longer breath in and to hold it a little longer to keep that air in the lungs and hopefully stretch those alveoli and stretch that lung tissue, but it doesn't serve the same exact purpose as it does for people with obstructive disease.
But what happens if in my case, it's supposed to, as you know, restrictive and obstructive. So I have both.
That's tricky. Okay. So again, the treatment is going to be similar. Okay. So in your situation, we hope that the exercise we're doing with you is going to improve respiratory mechanics, both inhalation and exhalation, meaning that it's going to help you to take a deeper breath in, and it's also going to help you to more smoothly and efficiently allow the air out.
And you're saying though, that based on that, that you could still see you might be able to see the improvement in the PFD, but at the same time, you can maybe experience that you're doing better cardio and it doesn't necessarily reflect in the PFD. That can happen too.
That's exactly right.
Okay.
But I still expect you to see, but I do expect you to show an improved PFT.
Right.
So what I hope would be that when you get retested, that you're able to, number one, take a deeper breath, and that you're also able to evacuate more air from your lung.
Thank you. Thank you for the explanation. That was helpful.
And one of the kind of ironic things is that sometimes when you have both obstructive and restrictive disease, they kind of offset each other. So like what I had one year, and this is a really, it's a kind of a unique case, but it's a woman who had very severe COPD for a long time. And she wound up getting lung cancer and she had two lobes of her lung removed. Right. And it just so happens that the two lobes of her lung that were removed were the part where she had the most severe COPD. So as crazy as this sounds, having those two lungs removed actually made her lungs much, much better because it got rid of that whole obstructive part. So sometimes there's some weird situations where they can offset each other.
Thank you.
8 minutes to go. Last
Rick. It goes Rick, then Tim, then Rob.
Rick, Tim, Rob, and I see Deborah Madison also raising her hand. I'm just telling you guys, I'm going to let you in on a little secret. Beth is using the not just this, she's using at the bottom where it says reactions, raise hand. That's so if you want to get on this line, it's like you could stay in the butcher shop for 2 hours if you don't have the ticket. You're not
well,
going,
these
you're not
people,
going to take your
actually not Tim like, and I've been Rob, here but for the 2 hours. Others, the others put their hand up at 20 after nine, so...
Beth, are you feeling crabby tonight?
Get moving now. Go ahead,
Rick. Let's go. Go ahead, Rick.
Hi, Noah. Hey, my question's on exercising.
Yes.
I exercise on the treadmill 7 days a week.
Great.
I do about a hour and 15 minutes, hour and 20 minutes. And I've been going really for duration.
Too long and not high enough in intensity. I could tell you that right off the bat. If you could do an hour and 20 minutes, then that means you're not working hard enough, right? And let me show you something. If you go to, if you do a search and you say Noah Greenspan, best looking person. And now if you go to treadmill 101, right, it's going to take you to this right here. You don't have to do an hour and 20 minutes by a long shot. Okay. We do.
Well, it certainly wears me out and I'm kind of shot for a lot of the day after that.
Okay. So you're doing 7 days a week. You're doing much too much. Okay. Right. Look at these protocols here. Okay. So how fast are you keeping the same intensity the whole time?
I do vary that. The treadmill, only goes down to 1.5, height. It doesn't go all the way down, so it's stuck at 1.5. So okay. the incline's always on 1.5.
Okay.
I do a speed between 1.5 and 2.
Okay, so let me show you one thing. See this chart right here?
Yes.
This treadmill Met chart. So let's say 2 miles per hour, 2% incline. So that's 3.1 metabolic equivalents. See that?
Right. Yes.
Now let's say you went to 1.8 miles per hour and went up to, let's say, 6%. Now you're at almost 4 mets, okay? So right. What I would say is you can cut that workout way back to like 25 or 30 minutes, but look back here, there's all these different protocols. So what I would say is I would start somewhere around here, right? Which is kind of what you're, or even here, you know, so you can't do less than 1.5%, but start here, start inching your way up. And when you can do this workout easily, you go to the next workout and the next workout. But you see, none of these workouts go past 23 minutes, right? And these will get you in shape, but you'll get into much better shape by cutting the duration and increasing the intensity.
So the intensity clearly is more important than the duration.
Within reason. So if you do one really intense minute, that's not enough. But if you go intense and you do, see, this is the big problem with a lot of programs. They'll go in and they'll have you walking at 1.5 miles per hour and they'll have you do it forever. And you're like, it's not enough. And a lot of it, I have to tell you, I think is because staff is either not experienced enough or doesn't understand the physiology enough or is afraid. You got to be okay to push people, you know, but I think if you do this, you will see a major difference in not that long a period of time. 4 minutes to go. Let's go, people.
Thank you.
Jeff, who's next?
Tim, he's going.
Tim.
Yeah. Noah, my last pulmonary function test for IPF indicated a sustained forced vital capacity, but a significant drop in the they call it DLCO, diffusing capacity.
Yep.
My question for you, the doctor shook his head. He said he doesn't know why it's happening. We'll just test more frequently. But is there anything as far as rehab is concerned that I can do to improve that? Or is that simply something that just goes with the disease progression?
So when we talk about diffusion capacity, DLCO, that's a tricky one, right? And when we talk about interstitial lung disease, what we're really talking about, people say it, they don't always know what it means. But when we talk about COPD, asthma, emphysema, chronic bronchitis, we're talking about disease of the airways. And when we're talking about interstitial lung disease, the interstitium of the lung is kind of like the supportive lattice work and framework that supports the actual spongy lung tissue itself. And one of the problems with interstitial lung disease is that becomes thickened and scarred. And there's not a whole lot that rehab is going to do for that, unfortunately. Now, it doesn't mean you can't somehow think of it like this. If you have a car and your spark plugs are, old and your oil filter is filthy and you don't have the right amount of air in your tires, well, all those things are going to contribute to worse ride, right? And so if you put air in the tires, it doesn't take care of your spark plug and oil filter problem, but it makes your car a little more efficient. So sometimes there's not a lot, with the exception of like Ofev and Esbriet, which are like the only two drugs on the market now for pulmonary fibrosis. So we hope that that's going to hold it. And the thing is that by strengthening your heart, by, improving respiratory mechanics, by strengthening your muscles, we hope that the overall car will be a little more efficient. Okay. But sometimes progression of disease is really tough. And unfortunately, some of the medications, or the only two medications that are out, come with a lot of side effects. So, I wish I could say, there's a magic way to improve your diffusion capacity. I'm still a believer that getting your body in tip-top shape, nutrition, managing your stress and anxiety, the more you can do, the more it kind of shores up a problem, but it may not be enough to stop that DLCO from progressing.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. And I wish there was a better answer, than that. And hopefully someday there will be. But just as a form of perspective, when I first started treating interstitial lung disease in 1995, there were no medications, right? And there was nothing. And a lot of doctors didn't even test for it. Didn't do CAT scans, didn't do biopsies, because their thought was, well, what am I going to test it for if there's no treatment anyway, right? So we've come a long way since then. And I know that they're putting a lot of time, energy, and money into a cure, or at least a better treatment for interstitial lung disease. I, in my heart, believe it's coming. I really do. The unfortunate part is that some interstitial lung diseases really do move, kind of quickly. And so the idea behind taking Ofev or Esbriet, which is not necessarily going to make you feel better, and it's not going to reverse the scarring, but hopefully if it can prevent your disease from getting worse and, keep you around and keep you hanging on, then maybe you're going to make it to the next best treatment. That's part of it also. But I, again, it's still a challenging, and I've seen it come so far in the last 21 years or 26 years, but there's still a lot more to go. But I do believe we're getting closer. I mean, there's brilliant minds working on this around the clock. So hopefully we're going to get there soon.
Thanks.
Oh, Rob.
Rob.
Oh, thanks. Thanks, Beth. Noah, on the discussion earlier about attempting to maximize our oxygen flow, either yes. from our home concentrator or on e-tanks or portable oxygen concentrators, pulse versus constant. You talked about the non-rebreather, but Noah, I haven't heard you talk about the oximizer. And that's what I've been using ever since I came out of the hospital.
Sure. So the oximizer, for those of you that don't know, it comes in two forms. It comes either as kind of a mustache or it comes as a pendant. And what the oximizer does is the oximizer basically serves a similar function to the bag, right? And what that does is it creates a reservoir of higher concentration air because, most people don't have this, but I happen to have a trachea right here. And the thing is that this area here, your windpipe, is what we call anatomical dead space. And what that means is that none of the air in here can actually get into your lungs, right? So like if this is where the show is taking place, this is the hallway. And until you get in here, you can't see the show. So the oxymizer will give you a little higher concentration, but you're still losing a lot of air by using a cannula. And it, are you desaturating still with that oxymizer?
Not on a higher flow, no.
What? So how high do you have to go to remain saturated?
About five.
About five. Okay, so that's not a major issue. If you still weren't remaining saturated, then you could go up in liter flow and use a non-rebreather mask. So the non-rebreather number one keeps this here, and it also gives you this big reservoir, and that big reservoir should be about this much air so that you're getting almost 100% oxygen with each breath. And the oxygen will move in via a chemical gradient and a pressure gradient. So the oxymizer is fine. I don't use them with patients. I don't hate it. I don't love it. I think it's okay. I think if it's working for you, then by all means, keep doing it. I also don't use high flow cannulas. I don't hate them. I don't love them. But I think that, again, in your case, Rob, like you just described the exact way it's supposed to work. Now, if you were using, let's say you needed to go up to 10 liters with that, right? To remain saturated, and you were using a tank to do that. Well, then you're using 10 liters per minute, which means your tank is going to go very quickly. Then I would say you'd get more bang for your buck if you switched to a non-rebreather mask and came down to 6 liters.
Okay.
I mean, that's like, it's not that big. Like it's really small. So is it better than just a regular cannula? Yes. Is it major? I mean, I'd be curious to know, if you didn't have the oxymizer, if you just used a cannula, how different would it be? My guess would be it probably wouldn't be that different. I could be wrong.
Yeah, I haven't seen a significant difference. And again, it's more about what is the level of my activity
right. That
determines either how much oxygen I have to have on the concentrator or tank.
And then it's all supply and demand. So for example, if 5 liters is not, is not that much oxygen, right? So you can't even use a non-rebreather with 5 liters because it's not strong enough. But what you could use is you could use a standard mask. It has a name, which is I'm drawing a blank on what it's called, but it's like a standard mask. It's the one without the bag, and that would still give you much better bang for your buck.
Venturi?
No, not Venturi. Not Venturi.
Simple mask.
Simple mask, it's called, or something like that. But it's, simple mask. But it's the one without the bag, right? And when you're on those lower liter flows, then that will at least, you'll have the same thing as the oxymizer here in the mask, and you'll definitely get a lot more bang for your buck. So you might be able to even do 3 liters on the mask, which the difference between 3 liters and 5 liters in terms of time and conservation is huge.
It's significant. Yeah.
Thank you. Simple mask. Thank you for whoever said that. So, all right, 10 more minutes and I'm really out this time. My dog is pissed. My dog's like, 10 minutes? He just said, he was like, 10 more minutes? All right, Beth, who's next?
Well, actually, there was a Deborah and a Deborah that went before Helen and Linda, but I don't see them. The Deborah Madison, I think, wanted to. Deborah Morgan wanted to. Actually, both of you did.
Come on.
It's Deborah, and he did answer. No, you answered my question.
Perfect, but there is a Deborah Madison as well.
I had a pulmonary fibrosis.
Deborah Madison. Are you still here?
Nope, she's gone. Oh, yeah, she's here. There she is.
I answered it.
No, that's Deborah keeps saying that. There is a Deborah Madison as well.
Deborah's still here. Deborah,
my question on pulmonary fibrosis.
Wait. Deborah Morgan, we know. We heard you. I answered your question. Deborah Madison, yeah. Beth is talking about. I'm sorry, I'm not usually like, but Beth seems to have gotten strict. So I don't want to get in trouble either. Deborah Madison.
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I've got a question about exercise. What is your feeling about those bicycle arm things?
Love them.
Okay.
Fantastic. Love it.
That's my question.
That was easy.
Go, Helen.
Helen.
Thank you.
Helen.
She's coming. Speak, Helen. Speak.
Helen, she's not a dog. Helen, give me your paw.
She unmuted herself, but she's not saying anything.
She's playing hard to get.
Linda Sullivan.
Beth, you're running this thing like an auction. You should work at Sotheby's.
Monk is going to bark in a minute. We know that.
No, he just came and laid down. He's okay. Noah. He understands. Yes.
Noah, I'm not on oxygen yet. I sent you a message, but you probably didn't get it. I missed a seminar last night where Jennifer Wesco of the Wesco Foundation was on, and I was asking her if she'd ever heard of a product that was originally on Shark Tank a few years ago called Boost.
Nope. No help.
No what?
No help. Don't get it. It's a waste. It's BS.
Okay, but I'm not on oxygen yet, but I'm getting winded after doing some exercises.
Do some breathing exercises, learn the techniques. The Boost is not going to help you. The Boost came from a diving product, which is called a pony bottle. Okay. And the idea of this is that if your main tank, and when I dive, I carry this, and it's been so long that since I went diving, thanks to the pandemic, that I forgot even what it's called, but it's a little bottle that I keep strapped to my hip so that if my main tank fails, I at least have enough air to get to the surface. Okay. This oxygen boost is bullshit. Okay. That's what they should call it. They should call it bullshit because it's complete crap. It's not going to help you at all.
Okay. But I guess some hikers use it.
Some people use everything. Okay.
Some hikers are using it.
Good for the hikers. Okay. But trust me, it's not anything that's going to move the needle in any way, shape or form. You know, if you take that boost, right, that oxygen is going to be out of your system in 30 seconds anyway. And I don't even believe it's medical grade oxygen. I got to tell you, I think it's probably just air. That's my gut feeling, because how could they sell it otherwise? You know, it's like in Las Vegas, they have these oxygen bars and there you could get like pina colada oxygen, right? You need a prescription for oxygen. It's a controlled substance. So if they're selling it over the counter, I don't care if Mark Cuban uses it when he hikes up Mount Everest, it doesn't work. It's a good moneymaker for the company and for Mark Cuban. But that's it. It's not going to help you. Don't buy it. It's a waste.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Sorry, Mark. I love Mark Cuban, but that product stinks. And I hate when people, there's so much BS in the oxygen community. Trust me, there's a lot of criminal activity going on and a lot of real misleading information. Watch the video I did that's in this thing and you'll see it's where it says Vimeo. Trust me, a lot of these concentrators don't do what they say. And that boost certainly doesn't.
Go ahead, Renew. Renew?
Hi, Dr. Nohan. My question is about the, it's called pranayam. It's like a yoga and breathing exercises.
Pranayama, yes.
Yeah. So wanted your thoughts on it. Do you think it's helpful? And
yeah, I think it's fantastic. So people ask me a lot about pranayama breathing. People ask me about, you know, yoga breathing, which pranayama is part of yoga. If something, you know, there's no one way to do it, right? So what I advise you to do is try many different things and whichever one makes you feel the best, do it. No harm in that. Okay. It's just like when we tell you about, you know, breathing in for two and out for four. That's a starting point, right? It's a starting point. It's an initial ink stroke, but some people need in for three, out for six, or in for two, out for five. So experiment with different things. If something helps you, I would never tell you not to do it unless it was somehow dangerous. But pranayama breathing is fantastic. It's the root of yoga.
Yeah, thank you.
3 minutes to go. Who's next, Beth?
I don't have anybody's. Oh, suddenly a hand came up for Dream. These people are thinking about them as we go. Go for it, Dream.
This might be the last time they get to see me.
There's no more hands.
I actually waited because I wasn't going to raise my hand if we ran out of time. So my question is this. I have almost all of the things that you talked about that might interfere with your breathing, because I was fortunate enough to have cancer when I was in my 20s and I had radiation and chemo.
Yeah.
So I've got fibrotic lung disease and I have COPD and I have aortic stenosis and I have AFib and I have all these things. But the problem that I have is I do lose oxygen when I exercise or when I exert, but that exertion can be super minimal. So I tried to, I still have an active life. I do things. I work full time. I have grandkids, all that. So I'm trying to find something that will measure my oxygen either while I'm moving or with only a short stop. And by that, I mean my fitness watches won't do it. The pulse oximeters I find won't do it. I have to stop.
There
and
are
stand or sit still for like five full minutes.
There are for 20 full minutes. Did you?
No. Five full minutes. But then my oxygen I know is back up.
Right.
But I've
right.
now stopped exercising for 5 minutes.
Right.
So like, I need to know if I'm at 92, I'm going to keep walking. But if I'm at 85,
oximeters that come as a watch, and it's a watch, but then it has the finger piece. And those are usually better than, it's hard for me to wrap my head around like the Apple Watch being an effective oximeter. I don't know. It may not.
Well, the Galaxy Watch 4 is not because I can almost never get a reading off it at all.
So there are some oximeters that come with a wristband. So pulse oximeter with wristband. So I'll show you. See, I don't know. I don't trust some of these.
Yeah.
Let's see. Okay, so let me just show you one I've never used this one, but I've used one similar to this. And as compared to this, which somehow says they get it off your wrist itself, this one actually works like a pulse oximeter and it's got a finger piece. So I would look for something like that. Another really good one, like here's one, I haven't used this one. Like it's not gonna be cheap, like to get something like that.
Uh-huh.
Another good one that's really great is that's a great one. That's a good one. That's what I'm talking about. Because what that does is that keeps it going. It's not like it's searching for the signal. It's always got the signal. And another one that's really good that works with your phone is the Masimo, and it works with both the iPhone and the Droid, and it really it's very accurate. In my opinion, it's the best one on the market, and we use only Masimo at our center. It's a different technology, and it's really good. And it's 9:30, and I'm gonna say good night to all.
Okay, thank you.
So, again, this is the time when we pass the plate around the church. Take out your credit cards, go to pulmonarywellness.org and show your support so that these things can continue to provide dog food for this guy who's been patiently waiting for us to stop this meeting. So have a great night, everybody. I hope this was helpful to you. Next month, we're going to talk about nutrition and we're going to have some nutrition gurus here with us. So have a good week. Another thing is I am available for personal consultations via Zoom. You can register at www.noahgreenspan.com. Easy to remember. Take care, everybody. Have a great night. Breathe well and have a good time. You're still doing it. Bye-bye.
Good
Thanks.
Night. Good
thank
night.
You.
Thank
good
you
night.
So much, thank you. Noah. And thank you're you for welcome. Everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very
thank
welcome.
You.
Thank you. Noah. Good night.
Bye, guys.
Good night.
Thank you, Noah.
Noah.
Good night, Beth. Thank you. This is the Waltons
good night,
ending. This is the Waltons ending.
I always say good night, Jim Bob.
Okay, we're all in this together.
That's right. I see a lot of familiar faces I'm happy to see tonight. So good to see you all.
Thank you for your time, Noah.
My pleasure. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
What's better, PayPal or just a regular credit card?
Either one. You could just, if you could take your credit card and put it in an envelope and send it to me, that's the best. All right. Yes. Bye-bye, guys.